Thank you for listening to the Old 77 podcast.
Uncle Pictures! Uncle Pictures!
We just really made him sweat on that.
Where's your button at,
the
bro?
The button's not working.
What?
The button's not working.
All right, now hit it.
Good job, Board Op. Fucking Board Op over here isn't doing his job again.
Sorry, dude.
Still love you.
Fucking muted me, Dave.
I'm sorry, dude.
Every fucking show.
Oh. Who are you?
Hi there. This is the Old 77. It's a safe place in an unsafe world.
Shut the hell up.
Warning. Foul language may occur due to the subject matter.
No humping, no pushing, no sniffing hiding.
Become a subscriber at patreon.com/theold77podcast. Subscribers get bonus content and early access to episodes. Find out more at patreon.com/theold77podcast. Thanks for listening.
Sweet mother of God, what is the holdup?
From the Old 77 Studios in Jefferson City, Missouri, it's the Old 77.
It's a safe place.
In an unsafe world.
God, now we're all weird.
Hello.
Agey, guys.
I know.
It's so strange. It's like we've never done this before, because we have tonight Jamie from In the Groove.
Yes, sir.
Welcome, Jamie.
What's up, man?
Say hi. Thanks for having me on. Good to have you, man.
Yeah, sorry, it's like we're all rusty and stuff tonight.
It's like, what the hell's going on here, boys? Get your act together!
Oh. All right, so Jamie owns In the Groove Records.
Yep. You've been in business for like 20 years, man. You're a record store here in Jeff City. Tell us a little bit about it. And you're just now moving to a new location, too.
Yeah, I've been in the location now for about 12 years. And I decided it's time to move up and upgrade.
The place
I'm in now, it's falling apart. It's old. The floor's caving in. The walls are caving in. It was just, I made the decision. It's time to move on.
Yeah. Nice.
Yeah.
So tell us about the new location. Where's it at?
So the new location's only about a half a block away. So it's not that far.
It's not that far at all. No. Yeah.
And it's much better. I got new floor, central heat and air, which at the old place I didn't have that.
Yeah.
New flooring is in there, new bathroom, and we built a new wall in there, new paint, so it's all really, really nice.
Sweet. So when will you guys open up at the new location?
I'm hoping to be open April 19th. So
okay, well, that's just right around the corner.
Yeah, so week from Monday?
Week from Monday.
Not too far away.
Yeah. Are you going to do like a big like grand opening type thing?
Eventually, not right at first, but we'll do something. The RSD stuff, Record Store Day, that's coming up this summer.
Right on.
And there's a couple drops that they drop records, and we'll do something then probably.
Right on.
Yeah.
I was just going to ask, is Record Store Day this year going to happen? And it is, apparently.
Well, not...
Because we didn't really have one last year.
No, and not traditionally. It's
obviously.
They're just making a list, two lists, and they're going to drop records, what they call drops.
Mm-hmm.
One in June and then one in July.
Nice.
Okay.
Yeah. Yep.
Nice. That'll be fun.
Yeah, the list just came out. I just looked at it briefly, and I don't know a whole lot about what's coming out yet. I haven't had time to sit down and look at the list, but hopefully there's some cool stuff.
Yeah, what I love about In the Groove, I love just, you know, when I'm in there, it just takes me back. There's like this real nostalgic like thing about it. Mm-hmm. Like to have your hand on the music that you're listening to instead of like, because we're so used to like being digitized anymore. It's Spotify and iMusic and anything else. I mean, there's really like, there's no personal attachment to that kind of music. It's awesome to have the album in your hand.
Mm-hmm.
You can look at the artwork.
But that's something we really don't care about anymore, it seems like.
To flip on the vinyl.
The whole album.
Yeah.
And just hear that raw vinyl sound. There's something to it, right?
Absolutely, man.
Especially when you go into your place, like, you have a record on. Like,
yeah, we play records all day, every day.
It's amazing. Like, you go in and you know...
So how do you pick your record for the day?
That's a challenge.
Yeah.
And believe it or not, sometimes I get sick of that.
I know, right? I would.
And so sometimes I repeat stuff, you know, just because you're like, man, because all day, every day, day after day. But for the most part, I enjoy it, and I'll go through genres. So like I'll pick jazz or blues or soul, try to mix it up. That's about the only way you can do it.
Yeah.
So if someone else is like watching the front desk, say you're out and about, someone's watching the store for you, and whoever it is, do they have like the freedom to just throw whatever on, or do you have like a set playlist?
They have the freedom.
There you go.
If somebody's a friend or somebody's watching,
so you'll come in and you'll know exactly what's on because you're like, well, I know that this was going to be on because this dude's here.
Yeah, yeah,
that's
yeah.
But that's cool though.
Murder was the case.
Yeah,
it reminds me of that movie High Fidelity with John Cusack.
Oh god.
Oh yeah.
He's at record store,
mm-hmm.
and Jack Black's like one of his employees,
right?
And he's just like dancing in the aisle and shit, like. And those dudes were just hanging out, selling records, selling music. Like, a lot of those stores are just dying off now.
Yeah, it's not around
anymore.
Which
is good for you because, I mean, I'm sure you have people that travel four or 5 hours just to come see you guys.
Oh, yeah. People come from all over.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Do you keep, like, a record of, do you know who the furthest one away is?
I never have, but there have been some people from England.
Nice. Cool.
We've had people from Canada. Coming through, so wow. Yeah.
I was going through your all's Facebook page today or yesterday, and I was reading reviews from people that had left reviews, and there was one guy that was mentioning, like, anytime he's going, like, to St. Louis or Kansas City, he always stops at your store, you know, on his way to his destination.
Oh, yeah. People come from all over. Mm-hmm. All over the state. All over the country, really.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we know you sell vinyl records, obviously.
Yes.
What other type of stuff?
Yeah, yes. Right. Yeah. What other stuff do you guys sell?
We sell CDs and cassette tapes.
Mm-hmm. Do you guys sell actually turntables too?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Mostly vintage used ones.
Right on.
When I get my hands on one.
Yeah.
They're harder and harder to find.
Oh, I bet.
Because people are keeping them more and more now. Used to be able to come across them, you know, on a regular basis, but. If I come across a vintage one, I clean it up, set it up, you know, put new parts on it or whatever I need to, and sell those.
So I have an old turntable. It's not really an old turntable, but it's old to me. And my kids always mess with it when they're in the room.
Yeah.
And so I need a new needle.
Kids are scratching
on it. Can I get a new needle from you?
Absolutely.
Okay, cool. I'll have to do that then.
If I don't have one in the store, I'll just order whatever you need.
Are there different types of needles?
Yep.
Oh, okay. Dude.
Oh, many different
so
types.
So many types.
Can't shoot up heroin or anything with these things.
No, 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 no.
God. Let's hope not.
We support your drug habit here, too. You know what I mean?
Oh, no.
I'm just kidding.
I don't want to be a part of that.
We're having a serious interview here.
I'm bringing up
heroin. Sorry.
Drug.
Well, I need to get in there and get a new needle then.
Yeah,
and,
I can help you.
Yeah. And how often do you change those things? I've had the same one for like 7 years.
You need to do it. If you don't play it a lot, it's not a big deal. But if you play a lot, at least once or twice a year, you should.
Do you have like actual club DJs come in and be like, yo, you got needles, man? Like,
well, I mean, records.
Because, I mean, guys who scratch like that.
Sometimes. Not very often. Sometimes, but not very often.
I'm sure those guys burn through them like it's
Those guys probably have a direct link somewhere.
Yeah. They got special cartridges and needles. Yeah.
There's special turntables designed specifically for scratching.
Yeah, those are...
I wish I knew somebody that could do that.
Yeah.
You know, like a DJ
premiere. What, scratch?
Yeah, somebody that can scratch
records.
Don't
your kids scratch on your turntable?
Yeah, but it doesn't sound very
nice. Back in the day, I used to have two turntables with a three-channel mixer.
Yeah.
And I used to scratch. I used to have hip-hop records and stuff.
What?
So when I lived in Vermont, I sold all that stuff because I needed money. Like, I didn't.
Matty Fresh.
I made no money whatsoever in Vermont. So I needed to pay like this. So I got a DUI up there. This is 14, 15 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Damn.
And I needed to help pay for this DUI. So I had to sell
You had to sell
stuff.
All your gear.
But they were...
struggling artists right there.
Two Newmark...
Yeah, Newmark.
And a Vaztec mixer I had. I had a little sampler machine too where you can just like sample stuff.
Like an MPC.
I was into that stuff for a while, man. Like scratching and stuff like that. I never could figure it out. Towards the end there, I was actually like getting a nice grip on it. Like I can get like a beat matching, but also getting a guy's voice on like one point and just like scratching the shit out of it, and then twisting it, and then turning it into another record.
Holy cow!
It was cool, dude.
That is cool.
But I was in my 20s, man. Like,
I want to see Matty Fresh now.
Yeah, me too, Matty, man. Right? No Matty Fresh.
He's been buried for a long time. Been buried a long time.
R.I.P. Matty Fresh. Damn.
I wish I could have seen that, man.
Like, I was that, you know, that song two turntables and a microphone. Yeah, yeah. Well, that song was about me, like Beck and I.
You and Beck in the day.
Beck's like, look, Matt, I'm gonna make this song about you.
Beck liked to frequent the Vermont nightclubs, and
yeah,
you guys
him and I used to have like dance offs and shit.
Yeah, yeah, he's a good dancer, right here.
Oh, now that's too much.
Yeah, man, you know, there's this whole debate, because we were talking off the air, you know, I'm a musician, I play guitar, but a lot of my other fellow musician friends don't appreciate the art of hip-hop and, like, the art of, like, record scratching and sampling. How do you feel about that, Jamie?
I think it's cool.
Yeah.
I appreciate it.
Yeah. I mean, I understand why some people don't think that that's, like, you know, a pure form, a pure art form or whatever, but it totally is.
Oh,
man.
Yeah, it takes talent.
Absolutely. I've tried to do it, man. Yeah. Like, I can pick up a guitar and play chords for you all day, but I've tried to learn the hip-hop production side of things, and it's not easy.
Yeah, I couldn't do it. There's no way.
Now, you know, we've got a lot of really cool technology now that's making it easier for us to sample and do things like that. What are we looking at up here?
No, I'm just having Matt move the TV so it can be in the shot.
Okay. Ah, that's a picture of the new store.
We're looking at the store.
So what I'm digging is you have, like, these old-school tuners, man.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, those things are amazing-looking, and they're in great shape. Like, all of your stuff is just so vintage, and it has so much character.
Do you ever have anybody come in and want to, like, furnish a vintage man cave?
Yeah, people come from all over all the time. They want to buy a lot of the stuff that's on the walls,
right?
I don't sell it because it belongs to the store, and a lot of that stuff has, like, meaning where over time people that have come through the store, they've given it to me, or I've gotten it somewhere, so that stuff isn't perfect for sale, but everybody wants all the posters on the wall and all that cool stuff, but I never sell it.
Do you sell posters or anything?
No.
You should. I bet you could totally sell a ton of posters out there.
I used to a long time ago. Mm-hmm. Back when I first started, I sold them, but
I love the space in this place.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like you have high ceilings.
Yep.
Is this the new store right here?
Yeah, that's the new store. And the ceilings, they're 11 feet. And there's no drop ceiling like the old store had. Yeah.
That's amazing,
had the
dude.
Old drop ceiling, which I never did like.
That looks great with the ventilation
showing. Yep, it's all exposed. Has
almost like an industrial
feel. Yeah, an industrial feel, yeah.
So what's the address for the new location so people can find it when they hear us?
It's at 708 Jefferson Street.
Okay. So, yeah, so not too far from the old one, then.
Yeah, just half a block.
Right up the street, half a block. Yeah.
Yep. Now, if you're not from here, if you're from Alaska or Ireland or something.
Yeah, like, actually, it's funny you guys say that, because I think I found out who is listening to us from Ireland. So thank you to the Colcast Podcast. I think Nicole from the Colcast Podcast has been listening to us from Ireland.
Well, thanks, Nicole.
So, thank you very much, Nicole.
Thanks for that.
That's cool.
Now, if you want to check out this store Jamie owns, In the Groove Records, has a Facebook, obviously.
Yep.
Check him out. You can't miss it. Become a friend. Order online. Support Jamie.
It's at In the Groove Vinyl on Facebook.
Yes, In the Groove Vinyl. Yeah.
Where else are you at, Jamie? You on Facebook, Twitter?
That's it.
Just Facebook?
Yep.
Right on, man.
Ben was setting up something with Snapchat.
Was he?
Yeah.
Okay. Snapchat's a good one.
See, I'm horrible. I know nothing about this stuff.
No, I don't. It's complicated. It is.
It is, and it's getting more complicated by the day.
As you can see, I'm old school. I have all the old school stuff. Yeah.
Hey, man, there's no problem with that.
No, not at all.
I love that stuff.
In a world of digital music, this is still thriving, which is so... Well,
record sales are
which
up.
Which says something, man. Which says something about people.
Yeah. Well, people crave that nostalgia.
Well, and then, we were closed for the pandemic last year.
Obviously, yeah.
So I closed down for 6 weeks. And then starting back up, I was wondering, oh, man, what's going to happen? Are people going to be out? Are they going to... I've been so busy.
Oh,
it's
good.
Been busy nonstop.
Great.
And I guess people are finding, because since they're at home, they're buying records, chilling at home, and collecting. I mean, I guess that's what it's all about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I remember, I want to say last year, maybe 2019 was the first year that vinyl sales outpaced CD
That's
sales.
That's awesome.
Yep. Well, yeah, you can. There's a lot of places that don't even sell CDs anymore.
Right.
You can't go to like Best Buy and get them.
And at this point, like, if I were to go back and collect music again, it would be vinyl.
Oh, absolutely.
Vinyl. Like, I went CDs. It's such a kind of 80s, 90s way of listening to music. I'd rather just go old school vinyl.
You get all the artwork.
Put it on the turntable. Right. Let it play.
You get the lyrics most of the time.
Yeah, man.
You can't buy the artwork when you just buy a single now.
Yeah.
You know?
Now, there's an Eric Church song. It's called Having a Record Year.
Mm-hmm.
And the song's about, like, his girlfriend leaving him, and he was in bad shape. So, like, all he did was, like, sit in, drink, and get wasted, and listen to all of his records.
Just listen to records.
Basically, the song, that's the premise of the song. And it's a really good tune. Yes, it's country. But Eric Church is, like, a very good artist.
Mm-hmm.
But check the song out. It just reminds me of, like, having a record year. Last year was a record year. You had to stay in, listen to your vinyl.
Yeah, you did.
And that's it.
One of my favorite things about Spotify is that at the end of the year, they give you your Spotify Wrapped.
Have
you done that? Yeah, have you done that, Maddie?
I did. It was like the end of the year Wrapped.
Well, they'll tell you like what your most listened to artist of the year was.
It was Dave Jordan, Matt Francis, and Scott Merriman.
77, right?
That's what mine was.
The Beatles last year. Well, Old 77 was my number one podcast last year.
Yeah.
But my number one artist last year was the Beatles, which kind of surprised me. I mean, I love the Beatles. I've always loved the Beatles, but I guess I didn't realize that they were like still at the top of my list.
Nothing wrong with that.
If you just go by the amount of plays, they are at the top of my list.
Beatles or Stones for you then?
If I had to pick one?
Yeah.
Beatles.
Mm.
What about you, Jamie?
Beatles.
Yeah.
Beatles. Yeah.
I have to go Beatles too.
I'd have to go Beatles as well.
Hey,
right. It's unanimous.
And I love the Stones.
So what, we don't like rock and roll or what?
It's not that. It's just I think the Beatles there was so much dimension to the music. And they were the first ones to do that. They were entrepreneurs at what they did. The White Album, I mean, come on, man. Like,
right.
It's one of the greatest albums of all time.
Oh, yeah.
I know a lot of people.
It's a hard one to listen to sometimes when you listen to it now knowing how to mix stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
When you go back and listen to some of the Beatles stuff, it's kind of hard to listen to some of it as a person who knows how to mix it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because I had that conversation with an audio engineer here while back at work.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, well, this album, and Thriller are just absolute terrible. And I'm like, what are you talking about?
But these guys, I mean, they went through every stage of life making music. And you can hear it in each album.
That's the thing I always say about the Beatles, like the thing that separates the Beatles and other great artists from more mediocre artists is that pretty much with the Beatles, every album that you got was completely different than that album before. They evolved. Now, you could say that Rubber Soul and Revolver were almost kind of like the same album. But other than those two, man, like every album was a complete step away from the one before. They evolved. And there's a lot of bands that maybe evolve, but they don't do it as well as the Beatles did. And maybe it doesn't connect at the level it did with the Beatles.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. It's damn
you,
guys.
Oh. what's her face?
Oh, Yoko?
Yoko Ono. Damn you, Yoko Ono.
I had a cat named Yoko for a while. Yeah.
Was it an asshole just like she was?
No, she was a cool cat.
Did it hiss at you like,
No. Yeah, do you guys remember when
I posted? Dump the band, John. Dump the band.
You guys remember when I posted that video of Yoko Ono? It was right after the presidential debate. And I posted a video of Yoko Ono like just screaming and doing what she does. And, and so my caption was actual audio of last night's presidential debate.
Yeah.
Because it was almost as hard to listen to.
A coyote finally ate her.
Kiss me now. Yeah, man, I don't understand the whole Yoko Ono thing. Like, I don't.
He was in love.
He was in
love. She wasn't even that hot.
Right? Yeah. It didn't matter because he was in love.
He was in love.
Yeah, I don't think he was with her because of the way she looked.
He could get any woman he wanted.
Absolutely.
But
correct.
I think he just really saw Yoko as a true artist.
Yeah, you know, I think he's an artist, and he saw that she was an artist.
Right.
So, yep.
Yeah, man. That's.
I mean, if you're a Beatle. You basically, you can go out every day and be like,
you can
do
whatever you want.
I'm going to slay some ass today.
Yeah.
Right? You can do whatever you want. It's like,
it's
like you have a pass just to get some ass.
An ass pass, so to speak.
Ass
pass.
Yeah, they did.
Excuse me, I'm a Beatle.
Yeah.
By the way, my name's John Lennon.
Yeah. I'm from Liverpool.
Would you like to go back in that alley real quick?
Oh,
knock one out.
Dude, it was probably just like that, though. Just girls throwing themselves on these guys all the time.
Oh, yeah.
Are you a Zeppelin fan?
Yep.
Yeah, me too.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, how can you not be? I mean,
dude, Zeppelin.
It's Zeppelin.
How can you not?
I mean, I would maybe throw the Beatles in there, too, but, like, for my money...
Okay,
like, Zeppelin at their peak?
Yeah.
It's hard for any other band to match that for me.
Zeppelin or the Beatles, then?
It's tough, dude.
That's tough. It's neck and neck.
They're very different bands. Like,
they are. That's
you could
different.
Surely... I mean, the Beatles certainly, like, their range of music was wider than Zeppelin.
You wouldn't have Zeppelin, I think, without the Beatles in some regard, too.
Yeah, there's certainly some truth to that.
There's some truth, I think, to that.
Hi, Andrea.
Hey!
Hey, the wifey.
The wifey's in the house. We love the new cooler.
It's a beautiful cooler.
We have a new old 77 fridge in the studios tonight.
Nice.
Yeah, that was the first
thing
I saw.
Tonight's the inaugural fridge break-in. Yeah. Yeah.
Every week I come in here and there's something new.
Right.
See, Jamie, there's a reason why you're here tonight, man.
Yeah,
man.
Breaking in the new refrigerator.
We're going to break the new fridge in. Yeah. We're going to brand it, I think, maybe.
We're saving it for you, dude.
Awesome.
Yeah. I'm already giving it a workout.
Right?
Yeah. That's what she said.
So who's the best, then? Who's your favorite band if you had to pick one?
My band's always been The Who.
Okay. All right.
And I don't know.
That's a good one.
The characters, Pete Townsend, Roger, Keith Moon, and John, they are just all characters to me. And
absolutely.
I just,
Keith Moon blowing himself up. That's one of the funniest stories ever.
He was
crazy.
He was a killer.
He was, man. He was a beast.
Right?
He was a beast.
Yeah, I like Pete Townsend's songwriting.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And I like like I said, the characters of the band.
Yeah.
I connected with them. Not sure exactly why, I just did.
That's a big reason why, just in general, why I like that era, that 60s, early to mid 70s era, because there were so many characters, man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like the Woodstock era, the late 60s, and then all, The Who and all
that.
Yeah. And plus, I felt like musicians back in the late 60s, they really had something to say.
Yeah. Janis Joplin and Jimi Hendrix and all that whole era is my favorite.
Mine too, man.
I think that's my favorite.
I think it's because they knew how to say it.
Mm-hmm.
Because they have something to say now with today's music, but it's just a different way of saying it that we can't relate to.
And you'll never have another era like that.
No.
There'll never
be
that era.
No, because there were so many things that had to coincide.
It wasn't just the music, it was the world around them.
Yeah,
you know?
I was going to say, it was the war.
Yes.
It was everybody having access to psychedelics
now. Yeah. And it was free love, still going on.
Look at that time period. You have the 1950s, right, which was like your traditional black and white American family, like Pleasantville. Have you ever
seen
that movie?
Coming out of
that. Yep. It was like, Susie and Johnny, you're going to school again. You got the milkman coming by. He's like, hey, guys, here's the milk.
Yeah.
And then you get into the 60s and people start growing their hair long. And then there's bell bottoms.
Right.
And then you have psychedelics and everything's like, what the fuck is going on here?
Yeah.
Like, society changed so much in 10 years for that.
Yeah.
And I think that's what happened. It was just like this culture revolution.
Yeah.
And there were so many different voices. Man.
I'm glad it happened.
Yeah. No doubt.
I mean,
without a doubt,
it changed. It changed music forever.
Yeah,
that whole era.
I mean, look at the bands, The Doors, man. Jim Morrison.
Well, we got the poster on the wall
The guy right behind
me. There was nothing like The Doors ever.
No.
Ever.
And they accomplished so much in such a little time.
Yeah, same with the Beatles, man.
Beatles
all of that.
Too, yeah.
What was that, 7 years?
Yeah, you don't realize they weren't really together all that long.
Yeah.
They just cranked out a ton of material.
Yeah.
That's a lot of time in the studio.
Yeah.
At a time when no one really knew how to use a studio either, because they just got multi-tracks.
That's another thing,
figuring
dude.
It out.
Yeah. Yep.
That's another thing. They did a lot with less.
Absolutely.
Yeah, they had a 4-track tape recorder, so 4 different things could be recorded at one time.
Yeah.
Turn around, mix it down, then do 4 more.
But
then
you got George Martin. If it wasn't for George Martin,
right.
you
That's
probably
right.
wouldn't have the Beatles sound.
You're absolutely right.
George... Wasn't he often referred to as the fifth Beatle?
Yep.
Yeah.
Who was the guy that played, he played the keys or he played piano on one of the Beatles tracks? He was the only non-Beatles musician to be on an album with it.
I don't know that one.
Other than Eric Clapton, because wasn't Eric Clapton on the guitar solo for a while, My Guitar Gently Weeps?
I think so.
That was Clapton.
Hey, Dave, what you doing over there?
Mm-hmm.
Gonna sleep with your wife.
Know, Billy Preston?
I'm gonna steal your
wife.
It
was Billy Preston.
Billy Preston.
Billy Preston.
Yeah, I think that's who it was.
Yeah, no, you're 100% right. Now I gotta figure out what song it was that he was on.
I mean, could you imagine, like, you're the Beatles and, you know, you have a recording tonight and you're like, hey, by the way, Clapton's coming over.
Yeah.
Yeah, but they didn't even know who Clapton was at the time. So Clapton was like, oh my God, I'm going to hang out with the Beatles, right?
They're like, oh yeah, Eric, can you play, man? Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can do it, man.
Man, have you seen old footage when he was like in his early 20s?
Yes.
Man, he was on the guitar like no tomorrow.
He's just a beast. Yeah, everywhere.
He taught himself how to play.
Yeah.
Who are we talking about?
Clapton. Eric Clapton. He didn't know how to read music at all.
No.
He just kind of had that feel. Old slow hand.
I like hearing the stories of like Clapton and Harrison going to see Jimi Hendrix play, and he'd be like turned around playing stuff, so they couldn't steal chord ideas. Mm-hmm. And
think about that entourage,
right?
These dudes and they're before the Beatles got like huge,
right?
They're just like going around to clubs. These incredible musicians who are basically like underground music now, about to like hit the scene, right? With the
stealing
world
ideas,
but these dudes are just these dudes are just out having a good time listening to other artists.
Yeah,
that must have been one hell of a time. One entourage.
Absolutely, it was
like one of the greatest entourages ever. Yeah.
I think that's why we'll never have it again.
No.
Because you had all of those musicians hanging out in San Francisco.
Oh my God.
Could you imagine that now? Like, I mean, I think the last time really maybe was grunge. When you would have everyone from Seattle, you'd have
kind
guys
of all hanging out.
Yeah,
together,
you'd have guys like from Pearl Jam hanging out with guys from
everyone
Soundgarden.
Everyone knew each other one way or another. Yeah.
I feel like the '90s was really like the last good era of rock music.
It feels that way.
It feels that way, doesn't it?
It was.
And it's definitely the one era that comes close to, you know, the late 60s, 70s, and all that.
Yeah,
stuff.
At least in the feel, like the overall rebelliousness.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think one band that really kind of gets overlooked a lot of times is the Beach Boys, man.
Yeah.
They were a hell
Speaking
of a group.
Speaking of the Beatles and the Beach Boys went back and forth.
That was
the rival, right?
Yeah. Well, the Beach Boys would put out an album, and then the Beatles would have to put out an album.
Basically kind of answer for their
album. Yeah, Sgt. Pepper and Pet Sounds.
Yeah, I was going to say Pet Sounds.
Yep.
And that was a terrific album.
Oh, not a bad song on it.
Usually right at the top of the greatest albums of all time list.
Yeah.
Along with that one.
Yeah.
Although that's not even my favorite Beatles album.
What's your favorite Beatles album?
Probably Revolver.
I was just going to say mine's the remastered Revolver.
Yeah.
It sounds so good.
Rubber Soul is
Rubber
great.
Rubber Soul and Revolver for me. Like you said earlier, they
almost
have
the same
back,
album.
Yeah, that's kind of back to back there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and what was the other one that they recorded but released in a different order? It was Let It Be and
Let
Abbey
It Be.
Road.
Yeah, yeah.
So.
But Abbey Road's good too.
I love Abbey Road.
Abbey Road's a great one.
Well, you guys, have you ever heard the controversy over the Meet the Beatles album with the Butcher cover?
Yep.
Yeah.
I don't think
so. They had an original. It was like butcher meat, right? They were just covered in like butcher meat. And there was little doll heads and stuff all around. It was just weird.
It's pretty
grotesque.
That was
going to be like the cover for the album?
That was the cover of the album. Yeah. And the record label was like, nah.
Can't do this?
I think that
it was midway through because they released some albums
Yesterday
that way.
And Today, I think that's what the album was.
Was it?
I think so, yeah.
I thought it was Meet the Beatles.
Meet the Beatles.
Well,
But then they reshot it and they had a different cover and they were all like very somber looking.
There were two different editions
of the trunk cover. There was a trunk on the cover.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
There were two different editions of that album because one of them was called Meet the Beatles and the other one was called With the Beatles. And I think that With the Beatles was like the UK version.
I could see that.
But then they called it Meet the Beatles when they came to the States. Yeah, I'm trying to find the cover of that that album that you were telling me about.
It's different.
I had no idea. I thought I knew all.
It's actually kind of shocking when you look back at the time.
Yeah.
Like that was in what, 60, probably 60s,
mm-hmm.
early 60s, early to mid.
Yeah.
I can see them going, oh my God, what is wrong with you? Don't do that.
Yeah. That would have been like 63.
Yeah.
Roughly. Yeah. That was about when that first album came out. Yeah. Are you a Dead fan, Jamie? Are you a Grateful Dead fan?
I am, but I don't
You're not obsessed with them.
No, yeah. I don't know. I listen, but I'm not like deep into the Grateful Dead.
Yeah.
But yes, I appreciate the Grateful Dead.
Jerry, man. Jerry, man.
I have to be in the right mood.
Yep, I do.
I have to be in the right mood, but yep. I definitely
in the right mood.
These are the ashes of Jerry Garcia, man.
I mean, really, the Dead are, in a lot of ways, they were just almost like just like an old folk band.
Yep.
A lot of the songs that... Holy moly.
That's more of a cult following anyways, isn't it? The Grateful Dead?
Yeah.
Holy shit.
I remember like, you know, being a young kid, like 6, 7 years old, and then like watching like a promo on TV back in the day, and it was like, the Dead is coming to the Spectrum. And then you see like a bunch of skeletons dancing. I'm like, what the hell is this?
What are these people into?
But then like older followers have like tie-dye and shit.
Well, that
and,
was like, they had a resurgence in the 90s.
Yeah.
Yeah, because Touch of Grey.
Touch of Grey.
Touch of Grey.
That
I think a lot of those people also are fish heads.
Yeah, well, when Jerry died, a lot of the Deadheads started following fish.
I don't know much about fish.
Trey Anastasia?
Yeah, I've seen fish a few times.
Have you?
Yeah.
Pretty much.
I drug my wife with me to a fish show a couple of years ago. Yeah. She enjoyed it. I mean, dude, going to a fish show, and I'm sure the same could be said for going to a Dead show back
We've
in the day.
We've talked about this. You're a fish guy.
Yeah. It's like, but it, like going to a fish show and being in that environment, it's like literally being on a completely other planet, you know, especially from what we're used to here in Missouri.
Sure. Yeah.
But, I mean, it's a fun environment, man. It's a fun environment.
Dave Matthews is right up in that kind of genre of music.
Yeah, they're very jam bandy.
Like, especially, I mean...
Well, it's a show.
Look, whatever you say about Dave Matthews, seeing them live is definitely an experience in its own.
They're a great live band. Absolutely, they are.
I've seen them 3 times
one
summer.
I've never got to see them.
I saw them in Hershey, in Philly, and also in...
The Gorge?
Pittsburgh.
Pittsburgh, okay.
The Gorge.
I had the Gorge in my head.
Wow.
Is that the one in Washington?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's a that looks like a great place to see a show.
I would love to go to that one. The other one I would really like to go to is Red Rocks.
Red Rocks.
I've never been to Red Rocks.
That place is like amazing to just. It's like a natural, like a
amphitheater.
It's naturally made for all these musicians.
Or Austin City Limits.
Yeah, that's another.
Like that. I heard that thing's huge.
Yeah, I'd like to go to that.
That'd be another.
Do they still do Austin City Limits?
I think they do.
I just see it because I don't have any. It's PBS, right?
I believe it's on PBS.
Yeah.
I'm sure that'll be back this year.
Yeah.
A lot of artists are coming back now, man.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm starting to see some bands are starting to announce some concert dates and stuff.
Especially in Texas, baby.
That's exciting.
Yeah, nobody gives a fuck in Texas. Yeah. Well, and like guys like Joe Rogan and Dave Chappelle, they're doing these comedy shows and stuff too.
Yeah.
But they're kind of weird, like... I know some of them are doing like drive-in comedy shows.
I think they're actually outdoor ones. Yeah.
I think Dave did a show in Texas with at a regular venue.
Yeah, was that the one? Was that one of the ones where him and Rogan? Split
and there was
the
a bunch of cats, a bunch of stand-up guys were there. Like they had their like. It's funny because Chappelle and Rogan are like in the same kind of circuit of comedians, and then they have like a bunch of other dudes.
Yep.
Who are like part of their posse, their comedic posse.
Yeah.
And I think wherever that like Dave goes, I think Joe's there too.
Yeah, it seems like they split the bill a lot of
like time. I know they're really close.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, listening to the podcast.
Yeah, Dave's been on
there,
hasn't he?
You can hear their rapport.
Yeah. Dave's been on that on
Oh, plenty
that
of times.
Podcast.
Yeah.
That's what I thought. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so
speaking of podcasts.
Yeah.
Jamie's a huge podcast listener, right?
Yeah, that's what he was telling us earlier.
I've never listened to a podcast.
You never listened to one, but you're now on one.
But I'm on one now.
On one, yeah, absolutely.
And it's cool. It's cool, guys. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for coming. We're excited to have you. I was excited when I found out we got to have you on.
Yeah, Dave kind of found out last minute. And he was like, really? Yeah.
Yeah, I figured, okay, we could talk music, man. I could talk about it all night.
That's what I love.
Yeah.
We're going to take a break real quick.
Yeah, absolutely.
Don't forget to check out Last Flight Brewing Company. They're on Heisinger Road in Jefferson City, Missouri. They make their own beer. It's outdoor seating. You can bring your dog. You can bring your kids. They have food trucks. Food trucks.
Yummy.
And so they have a different variety of food there
every week.
Absolutely.
But a brand new place. It's by the Pound and UPS. Go check them out. It's a great place to go on a nice sunny day. Chillax.
And don't forget West Main Pizza.
That's right. But especially don't forget about In the Groove, their new location, 708 Jefferson Street.
Kick Yeah, we got it up on the board so they can see it.
And don't forget about us, because we're the Old 77 on patreon.com/theold77, or you can call the listener line.
Yeah, at 573-246-0779.
And we'll be right back with Jamie Richter from In the Groove on the Old 77.
Your memories. Pregnancy, kids growing up, family, senior year of high school, getting engaged. You want to keep those moments forever. But the problem with most photographers is they decide which moments you keep. They'll sell you a single picture or a big all-inclusive package that might include photos you don't want at a cost that's outside of your budget. That's why I don't. You decide. A single photo, a single hour, you choose. You get all of your edited photos, everything, at Andrew Marie Photography. You get quality photos at prices you can afford. After all, they're your memories. Find us on Facebook, Andrew Marie Photography and Custom Design.
And welcome back to the Old 77.
It's a safe place.
In an unsafe world.
Yeah. So what's up, fellas? We're back with Jamie. It's trivia time.
Welcome back.
Hello.
Ooh, trivia.
Are you nervous?
Nervous? Not too bad.
So it's a tradition here on the Old 77. We always throw trivia to all of our guests' way. We put them under the gun, so to speak. And it's not like any other radio station trivia or any other radio trivia or anything like that, because we don't do any prep work here.
No.
So you might get the same question asked twice.
Oh.
Maybe thrice if you're lucky.
We will try to avoid that.
All right.
So
we'll try to avoid it.
I'm going to try to stick, because Jamie and I share a favorite era of music, and I think Francis also. All three of us love the late 60s / like early to mid 70s era.
Yeah, man.
So I'm going to try to keep your questions.
Try to keep them there.
In that range. Right, so cool. I've got one ready.
Are we ready?
I'm ready.
Question number one.
Thank you, senor.
See.
Dave, you can go and give the first question, sir.
Okay. What 1970s group originated such songs as Make It With You, Baby, I'm a Want You, and Guitar Man?
Bread.
I knew that one. That's correct.
Good job. Very nice.
He's 1-0.
1-0. 100%.
Number two.
Thank you, senor.
Si.
What decade is the hit single Carry On Wayward Son by Kansas from? What decade is that hit single from?
What decade?
Yeah, what decade?
The 70s.
That is correct.
Yes.
Okay.
I felt like that was a trick question.
Yeah, at first I was like,
Jamie's looking at me like
did it come out? Did it come out in 69?
Yeah, yeah.
But it only got big.
Just a decade, yeah.
Just a decade. Okay. So far, 2-2. Question 3.
A physics student and dentistry student formed a band named Smile in 1968. They were joined by an art student in 1970 and changed their name to that by which they are now known worldwide. They added a bass player in 1971 and released their self-titled debut album and their first single, Keep Yourself Alive, in 1973. Who is this rock band?
Who is the rock band?
Mm-hmm.
Smile?
Well, they were called Smile, but now they go by a different name.
That's technically correct.
Kind of, yeah.
Oh, it's...
You want me to read it to you one more
so
time?
So that was their first band.
So a physics student and a dentistry student formed a band named Smile in 1968. In 1970, they were joined by an art student and changed their name to what they are now known as. They added a bass player in 1971 and released their self-titled...
Is that Aerosmith?
Is that your final answer?
No, I just threw it out there. That was my guess. No. I should know this. I don't know why I don't.
Queen.
I knew that.
Queen.
Gosh.
The only reason why I would have...
I knew that.
Only reason why I would have gotten that one is because I know that Brian May is like a legit physicist,
right? That's right, yep.
Yeah. I didn't know that
until
recently.
The dentist threw me off.
Mm-hmm. Which one of them was the dentist?
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know either.
I'm not sure.
Surely it wasn't Freddie Mercury.
No.
He would have had that shit fixed.
He would have had that shit fixed. I walked right into that joke, didn't I?
Okay.
Right. Question number four.
Who played the drums in the group Thin Lizzy?
Oh, gosh. I don't know that.
I don't know that one either. That's a good one.
That's a good one.
Dave?
I just know. I just know Phil Lynott, the bass player and main guy. That's all I know.
Brian Downey.
Yeah.
Sorry, dude. I thought maybe.
Phil's great.
Yep.
Okay.
Great. All right. Question number five.
Question number five. What Allman Brothers song with a female name has a song length of 7 minutes and 28 seconds?
Jessica?
Yep. Cool. Good job.
Which is a great, great song.
It's a great song. It's also my wife's name, too. So
right on.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Let's make this more awkward.
Hey, Jessica.
Had to give her a shout out.
Do another push-up, will you?
Dude, how many is she up to now?
She's like putting us all to shame, by the way.
I know. Dave's wife, legit, is like this workout machine.
Really? Like just putting us all to shame.
She's the female Terminator, I swear.
She's turning into the female Terminator.
You ever go to bed and she's like, Dave, I'll fucking kill you. You
know, yeah, I'm always on my best behavior these days.
Every night I check under my bed for Dave's wife. She's going to come kill me.
Scott puts a drink down. He's like, feels an arm come out. It's Jessica's hand. That sounds like a horror movie. Jessica's hand.
Never to be seen again.
Oh my God. Question number six.
Coming this fall, Jessica's hand.
Doing push ups.
There's not enough blood in the room. Okay. Is this my?
Yes,
yeah, this is
yours.
Okay. This is you.
Question six.
What band's co-founder died in a motorcycle accident in 1971?
Motorcycle accident.
Yeah, what band's co-founder died in a motorcycle accident in 1971?
Is it another Allman Brothers?
Boy, it feels that way.
That is correct.
That's an Allman Brother.
Good job.
What's up with them and motorcycle
accidents? I was going to say that was Dwayne, wasn't it?
Yeah.
They like to live rough, crazy, and wild.
Okay. Question number seven.
Question number seven.
Number seven. Seven. Okay. So this is like right from the end of your wheelhouse era, Jamie.
Uh-oh.
So we're going to go 1975.
All right.
All right.
A band from Texas received considerable airplay with a song called Tush. Can you identify this group?
That's an easy one. ZZ Top.
Very nice. Good job. I hope I wasn't too late.
Softballs,
nope.
Dave.
I know. I can throw some hard ones out here soon.
Give us a Steely Dan one.
Okay, you want me to just ask a question and you guys know ahead of time that the answer is definitely Steely Dan?
Please, Dave.
Ricky, don't lose
that
number.
Okay, this one might be a softball. May not be. Mm-hmm. What Led Zeppelin album featured Stairway to Heaven?
That would be self-titled or Led Zeppelin 4 or whatever they call it.
Some people call it Zoso. Correct.
Yeah, Zoso. Yeah.
Okay.
I was over here like this. Like, 4!
Okay. Question number 9?
Yes, we 5, 6, 7, 8. Yes, we are in question number 9.
Okay.
How many are we doing? Just real quick.
I think we're doing 15, we decided.
Okay. So we should have played the Bon Jovi a long time ago.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. Question number 9.
Yes.
What was the 1970 Jackson 5 song that also became a hit for Mariah Carey over 20 years later?
Say that again?
Yeah. What was the 1970 Jackson 5 song that also became a hit for Mariah Carey over 20 years later?
That's a good question.
So she remade the song, but it's a well-known Jackson 5 song.
Mm.
One of their more well-known
songs. I feel like I should know
this.
Yeah,
I know. Me too.
Man, I used to listen to Mariah Carey all the time when I was watching Lifetime Channel.
Yeah. A Jackson 5 song. Why do I not know this?
I mean, I could give you multiple choice if you wanted.
Damn it, you kill me, Francis.
Should we give him multiple choice?
Is there multiple choice?
We can do that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so here's your 4 choices. I'll Be There, I Want You Back, ABC, or The Love You Save.
I was going to say I'll Be There, but... That was in my head, but I was like,
you gotta go with the gut.
That's a tough one.
You gotta give Mariah Carey some credit, though, man. Like, back in the day, She could hit that high point like nobody else.
I'm pretty sure she still is in the Guinness Book of World Records for the highest note.
Decibel?
Ever. Yeah. No, not on decibels, but the highest pitch note ever hit on a song. Yeah. And I think it's the song Emotions. You got me feeling it. When she hits that really high note.
It's that whole weird, like, that she can get.
It sounds like a scream almost.
She was, like, when she hit the scene, man, everyone was like, damn.
She's hot.
Yeah, she was.
Right? She's still hot, though, really. Yeah.
Is it like Nick Cannon dating her or something?
I don't think they're together anymore.
I don't think so.
She probably beat him or something.
I think they're divorced.
He got tired of her picking him up to move him.
Yeah.
You Nick, singing I need to get around you here.
You think if you wake up in the morning and when Mariah's in the shower, she's like singing all of her songs, like just singing her own shit?
Possibly.
Will you shut the hell up? I heard all that shit on the radio.
You know, it goes back to that old adage, though. No matter how hot she is, some dude's tired of her shit.
Yep.
That's true.
Yeah.
Question number 10.
Okay,
fellas.
We are almost there. What's the record right now, Scott?
Right now, so
I guess we got to do percentages since we have done different numbers of questions for different guests.
You know, we probably should.
Yeah.
Right now, we're at 6-7-2.
Well, that's pretty good percentage.
Not bad, 7
buddy.
Yay, 2
not
no.
Bad.
You're doing well.
I should have known the smile one. I should have known.
Yeah. I think it was an admirable guess.
The drummer for Thin Lizzy.
Yeah,
I wouldn't have been able to give you that one.
But you knew the lead singer.
Yeah,
so,
I know. Yeah.
But drummers are hard because they never get any of the credit,
right?
Unless you're Dave Grohl.
Yeah,
right.
Right. Serious.
But that's just because he plays guitar too.
Well, that's because he's the biggest rock star in the world right now.
Right.
He's a badass.
Okay, so here's question number 10.
Yes, sir.
The classic 1968 recording of "Indagata da Vida" was how many minutes long?
How many minutes was in Indagata da Vida?
If you get it close, I will give it to you.
Close? I'm going to guess it was 16 minutes and 27 seconds.
Is that right on?
17 minutes long.
Oh, right on. That's close enough.
It goes so
on
back
and
in
on
the day
on
when
on
my
on.
Friends and I would be getting stoned and you're just sitting there and you still hear that song, but it was like in the drum cell, you're like, is this the same song, dude?
Yeah, absolutely.
No, this is still Indagata da Vida.
Yeah.
Then you hear him come back, and he's like, Indagata da Vida.
I just remember The Simpsons where Bart switched out at church.
Yeah, yeah, he started
the
playing.
The organist lady's sheet music with Indagata da Vida. And like 20 minutes later, she just collapses on the organ.
That Matty Fresh just described every single Fish and or Grateful Dead song ever.
Yeah.
Like, man, I was listening to the song, and then like 7 minutes later, I was like, wait, is this still the same song?
I'm glad Dave's bringing up names that I haven't heard in radio in like fucking 15 years.
Dude, we've heard Matty Fresh a lot lately.
We heard Matty Fresh last
night. Please do not call me that anymore.
Okay,
right
I'm sorry. Okay, I'm sorry.
I am the artist formerly known as Matty Fresh.
Okay.
You can't be called that anymore.
So can we get just like a symbol for you now then?
You know? Yeah, it's like my finger.
I was
going to
say it's
his
middle finger.
All right, fair enough. What are we on? 11?
We are on question 11.
Okay, number
Jerk
11.
Off.
Okay, here we go. Eric Clapton's hit song, I Shot the Sheriff, was originally performed by which artist?
Oh, man. Bob Marley.
Give him a ding, ding, ding.
There it is, baby.
Very nice, very nice. I thought you'd had that one.
Too. Fucking prick. Damn you, Dave.
Question 12.
You bring up the past.
Sorry.
No, it's all right, because I always yelled at you about the board hopping, so
we're even.
It's fine.
Man, he really took that rough.
Oh, I feel like you're going to get this one. Which band produced three legendary guitarists? Ooh. Jeff Beck, Jimmy Page, and Eric Clapton.
Yardbirds.
Yeah.
Good job.
That's a good one.
Okay.
All right, boys.
This is not a trivia question that I'm reading, but I know Maddie knows the answer to this question, and I'm pretty sure you do too.
Okay.
So here it goes. Who played bass for the Doors?
Oh, I know this one.
Oh, who played bass? That's a tough one.
Mm-hmm.
It's a trick question.
It's a trick question.
Well, they didn't have a bass player.
Give him a ding.
So, who played bass?
Did Robbie Krieger?
No.
It'd have been Ray Manzarek.
Because Ray was doing the bass with his left.
We'll give you that, though, because that was basically the right answer.
I mean, I was completely satisfied with just the Doors didn't have a bass player. That's Jamie, 100% correct.
See, some of the questions Dave does ask, we call them Dick Slayer questions.
We'll get into that later, too. There's a whole story about
that. When you're
that.
Doing well and you feel the momentum of like just success, Dave comes in and just fucking crumbles
it. Oh, he just kills you so hard. Just takes you right out at the knees.
Yeah.
All right.
All right, boys. We've got question 14 up.
Okay. What band started off by playing at venues on the Jersey Shore? I mean, who's the biggest rock and roller from New Jersey?
It would have to be Bruce Springsteen.
That is correct.
Very nice.
And the E Street Band with Max...
Max Weinberg.
Max Weinberg. You know, he was a great drummer, dude.
Dude, Max is phenomenal.
Let's not get it twisted, okay?
Just because he played for Conan doesn't mean he's not still a badass. Yep. All right, here we are. Is this it? Is this the penultimate question?
No, the last one was the penultimate.
That's
question.
Right. The penultimate is the last question.
Yes. This is the final question. None of the scores matter. It's all up to this one. All for the schmoles.
The schmoles.
Okay, boy, I got two good questions here. I gotta pick one. Okay. Okay, here we go. Gonna stimulate some action. We're going to get some satisfaction. We're going to find out what it's all about. Who is the artist / band who had a hit with this song? Going to stimulate some action. We're going to get some satisfaction. We're going to find out what it's all about.
Can you sing it?
No.
Eric Clapton, right?
Good job.
That is a hard question.
I had to think about it for a second.
What's the song?
What's the song?
Do you know the song? Does anybody know the song?
I do, but it's just because I read it. But I think I would have known it even without reading it.
That's what I was thinking.
Let it all hang out after
midnight. Yes.
Good job.
Great tune, man.
All right, so what's Jamie's final tally? He did pretty damn good.
Jamie did damn good. Jamie only got two wrong.
Wow.
So he's like up there with Jackson.
We got 13-2.
Good job.
So I would actually rank him like number one above.
I don't know. We'd have to bust out the calculator because there's decimals.
I've been keeping them.
Winning percentages. Yeah. But I mean, like, music questions are...
Dude, those were all hard.
They're tricky.
There were some hard ones.
You did very well. Yeah. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Proud of you, dude. Proud of you. I know we just met, but I'm proud of you.
I mean, it certainly helps that you own the record store.
Yeah, that helps.
Yeah, I mean, that's...
In the groove, baby.
Check them out.
Yeah.
Check them out.
In Jefferson City. It's one of the main attractions here. One of the main attraction stores when people stop through Jefferson City.
Yep.
They love to stop by the record store. It's nostalgic. That's what I love about it. Honestly, it's you go in there, just the vibe.
Thank you.
It's just awesome.
Because we really don't have any, other than Jamie's place, we really don't have any real record stores left in Jeff City.
No,
man.
I don't know any.
I used to love going to Hastings back in the day.
Oh, yeah.
You know, but
spent many hours in there.
It's the coolest place. It's the coolest store.
Hastings was cool.
Yeah. Yeah. Especially for a music lover, music collector.
Yeah, because not only could I find albums in Hastings, but I could find like sheet music for bands that I like too. Yeah.
Right.
So, Jamie, I know you got a ton of old albums. Do you actually get vinyl editions of like new releases as well?
Oh yeah.
Okay, cool.
Yep, I do new and used.
So is that something like, do you actually stock new releases as well, or is that something like if somebody asks for a new release on vinyl, you order it for them?
So what I do, I got a distributor and I go through and I get a pick what I want to order new. Mm-hmm. But what I try to do is like get new reissues of old bands and stock the store that way.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I'm ordering, I'll take a chance and get some newer bands here and there.
Right.
But for the most part, I try to keep it old school.
Yeah.
But I love some modern.
Yeah.
When I can, you know, when I'm ordering and I see, ooh, there's a new band and that album looks cool or something, I'll do that. But for the most part, I try to keep it pretty old, like 60s, 70s, 80s.
You know, they say never judge a book by its cover, but I can with 100% honesty state that there are some albums that you absolutely can judge by the cover. Like, there are so many good albums that I've discovered just because I liked the cover art.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
I think the last time I was in the groove, they had the Chronic. It was Dr. Dre up on the wall. Nice. I was like, oh my God, that is great.
Yeah, well, I mean,
I wore so many CDs of that out.
Yeah, I had that. Oh, yeah,
White Boy in the Country rapping the Chronic.
Yeah, me too.
But what a iconic hip hop record.
Me and my buddies had, because there's an instrumental version of that album too.
Right? It really is. It is. It has to be at least top five, right?
Oh, easily.
I love it.
I mean, it cemented Dr. Dre. He didn't have to do another album for a decade almost.
And that album was pretty awesome.
Yeah, and then that album was great too.
Kind of sort of the same name as that one. Wait, I think that album is technically just called 2001.
Yeah, 2001.
But everybody refers to it as Chronic 2001.
Yeah, Chronic 2001.
And the cool thing about that album was that they also released a completely instrumental version of it. Oh. So me and my also very highly white friends would cruise around.
Get together and rap
and
it.
Freestyle in my buddy's car, smoking massive amounts of weed, listening to instrumental versions of Dr. Dre, man. I have some very fond memories of doing that.
Did you have a system in your car?
But my buddy that was driving us around did. Yeah, my buddy that was driving us around had a system.
I had to have a system.
Yeah. Of course.
Every last dime I had on my system for my car.
I mean, I did have nice speakers in my car at one time. Yeah, I think everybody.
Wasn't that amazing, like, back in the day?
But it was expensive.
When you were a kid, and that's the only thing that mattered was, like, the system that you had. I had, 6x9s. I had an amp with a box. And, like, you think the better, you know, the more powerful the system, the more ass you're going to get or something.
I don't know.
Like, is it like certify your coolness status or something?
Yeah.
I mean, here you're coming for a mile up the road.
But there were some cars who had, you know, systems, and it just sounded like a box rattling. Like,
boom,
it sounded terrible.
Yes.
It was like, brr, brr,
oh, yeah, the trunk was rattling apart.
I'm like, dude, get that shit installed.
Yeah.
Stop laying it on your floor.
I wonder, is that a thing that kids still do?
I think so.
Jamie just asked that.
I still hear cars thumping.
Yeah, but I don't.
Yeah,
hear
but I don't think
systems.
It's quite like it used to be.
Mm-hmm. Like, systems were like, you know, people used to. Mm-hmm. I mean, sometimes like guys would have their wiring would be all messy and shit.
Oh my god! I had a buddy who had a Nova, and the whole back seat was just full of speakers and cabinets. And
my friend Steve Vacciano, he had this like old school Cougar, man. And he had this fucking giant box in the back of the trunk, and it was all like rigged. Yeah. Well, you see the wires everywhere, and when you sit in the back seat, there was like no room, but you had wires up your ass.
Because you did it all yourself. It was too expensive to pay for it.
But the system sound good. Yeah. It just like he was just a slob with installation.
You know that? Yeah. That sounds right. Yeah.
Like, man, this shit sounds great, but your car looks like shit.
Yeah. I remember going over to my buddy's house, like, right as I graduated high school, and he'd be like, oh, hey, and he pulls his radio out. And here, congratulations, let's put it in. So he just took his radio out of his car. Later, I found out he reported it stolen.
What?
I mean, that was like 20 years ago, so it doesn't matter now.
Oh,
but
geez.
Yeah, man. I mean, you know, but still, and it just, I remember that, like, it sounded so great. Just the new CD player, because I'd never had a CD player before.
Well, they had competitions.
There was competition
for like the lowest bass decibel and all that. Yeah.
But I remember like riding around and like you'd just be bumping
low
this music.
Riders with the ground effect.
And like usually you're like probably sharing a blunt or something with your friends. And by the time you park and get out of the car, you can't hear shit because the system was in your ear.
Yeah, your ears are ringing.
You're just driving around for the last hour with the system in your face.
Well, have you guys ever seen the one where they have the girl sitting in the car and they play the music and she's got real long hair and then that bass hits and her hair goes like this?
Yeah.
Or like the old Maxell, is it Maxell commercial?
The Maxell tapes.
Sitting in the chair and the audio blows.
Those were the good old days, though. Yeah, it was fun.
You would go into like, you know,
Fidelity,
some kind of.
Right?
You know, kind of car audio place.
Yeah.
And they'd have like all the systems, like all the speakers on one wall. Then they have like all the interfaces on one wall for like your radio. then they'd be like, well, this just came out. It was like a 12 CD changer.
Oh, yeah.
And you're like, this shit's the bomb.
Yeah, probably like, $600 or something.
Who knew that like the CD changer would only have like a 5-year shelf?
Yeah.
You know?
Is there a vinyl version of like the 6 CD changer? Is there a way to do that with vinyl?
Not that I know.
Mm. You okay. Stack you I know stack back the in the day they made
a record player for a car, for yeah. cars. But that's oh, old. Yeah. That goes way back.
Yeah.
Could you
yeah.
imagine
I've never
that.
Seen one.
Can you imagine all the skipping that thing?
Yeah. Oh my God. You're just driving along. It's yeah. like, yeah, something else.
sorry, yeah. officer. I was changing the record over.
Or like, if yeah. the CD scratch, you have like take it out and like fucking wipe it on your shirt and put it back in and get back to that track number.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
You have to carefully clean yeah. the groove mm-hmm. on it in the car.
I miss
while you're
days.
Eating McDonald's.
Oh.
I discovered so many like ghetto ways to clean CDs off. You know, man, there's. You had those little CD cleaner systems that,
oh,
you,
yeah.
that you could buy that seemed to never work for me whenever.
Do you remember the one that you would set it in, you'd squirt it, and then you would like
yeah.
run this buffer wheel
yes.
over it?
Yes, yeah. I remember that.
Yeah.
That's the one I'm talking about.
Oh, all right.
Yeah, it didn't work, though.
No, it never worked for me.
Yeah.
Scratch it up more than
right. yeah, fuck, they sold a ton of those things.
That's
man.
Why they sold yeah. them, man.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
oh,
yeah.
well, you'll have to go out and buy a new CD then.
Man, I hope that, like, the shit doesn't hit the fan, you know, like an asteroid or something. And because if that happens, man, like...
Oh, no internet?
I'm fucked.
Yeah, so am I.
I mean, I have a handful of CDs that I've held on to, and I have some old vinyl, too,
yeah.
but...
Yeah, I've got some vinyl.
So, like, my brand new Jeep doesn't have any CD players.
It's all auxiliary.
Any, like... Anything that's alternative, like backups.
Really?
Yeah.
I just have straight up Bluetooth, man, so if the satellites go out, I am fucked.
Yeah. Well,
I'm driving around in silence.
People are already kind of starting to collect CDs again.
Yeah.
Are they really?
Heard that, yeah.
Okay. I've heard that too.
Yep.
See, it's, man, it all comes back around, yeah. right?
I still have my old CDs though, and this CD, and I caught all kinds of shit from Sarah. She's like, you should throw all these out. I'm like, no, I can't. I got like an attachment to all these.
Yeah.
I've had these CDs for like 15 plus years, man.
We're the last, really the last generation that in our cars, we wagged around 100 CDs in
yeah.
a thing, you know?
Right.
And then at a stoplight, you'd have to go through every single mm-hmm. one of them.
Remember the little the sun visor
oh, yeah.
CD holder?
Yeah.
Oh,
mine
of course.
Always like fell off because I had so damn many
CDs. Too many
CDs.
CDs
in it,
you'd
right?
have two or three all stuffed into the same.
Oh,
one
yeah.
spot.
Oh my god!
Yeah, 4-to-1 slot.
Yeah, your
oh,
shit's man. All scratched up because you're just too lazy to take care
wrong
of it.
Wrong CD in the wrong jewel case, and you're oh, like, oh, I want to live. Wrong CD.
And then it screws the whole thing up, yeah. right? Your system's just shot.
Yeah.
I think the only like. A working CD player I have in my house is probably like my Xbox.
I think my computer's it.
Like, I think I can put a CD into my Xbox and it will play it.
Would it work in Xbox One?
I don't know
probably.
About that.
Oh.
But
I mean,
in my
should.
Old school, like Xbox 360, I'm pretty sure I can put CDs in there.
So in my house, like, I have Sonos speakers. They're wireless speakers.
Mm-hmm.
And so basically, I have the Sonos app. And so all my iMusic is transferred over to the Sonos app.
Right.
So I have all my playlists. So I don't even bother with CDs anymore.
Yeah, you don't need to.
You know? But if you would like to bother with CDs some more, and you would like some
right.
old school tech, I mean, absolutely. If you have no idea what Matt just said, and you'd like to get something a little more retro, you can definitely check out In the Groove.
That's right.
Because I've seen some of the coolest old school gear that, like,
oh great,
my
great
sister's
stuff.
1980s boyfriend would just drool over, you know. This guy spent
oh,
his
yeah.
whole truck, you know, he'd go out and spend his truck money on this stuff, you know, every week, bringing in new high-fidelity gear, new high-fidelity this,
mm-hmm.
Different reel-to-reels and stuff. Like,
yeah.
That was a thing in 82, 83.
Jamie, have you seen a reel-to-reel at all, like,
oh,
you know,
yeah.
when you're dealing
oh,
with
dude, I've seen some
many.
Certain dealers
yeah,
and
I've
all
seen
that.
Some reels on his
many.
On his Facebook page.
So do you have any in the shop?
Not right now.
Okay.
I just did. I just sold my friend one.
Get out.
Yeah. A really nice one.
That's cool, man.
The Techniques.
Oh, those
techniques
are the nice ones.
The nice one, yeah.
Those are the nice ones.
Really nice. Techniques 1500.
That's what the hip-hop guys use, right?
Oh, really?
Well, that's the Techniques 1200 turntable.
Yeah.
But this reel-to-reel was a Techniques 1500.
Oh, okay.
Like,
yeah.
Big monster.
Yeah.
Reel-to-reel.
Mm-hmm.
It's awesome.
See, if I buy a brand new turntable, say if I come to In the Groove and I buy a turntable there, like, I'm just asking for a bruising because, like, my daughter is 2.5 years old now. And If she sees that, she's going to want to, like, scratch it the hell up.
For you, I don't know if
get
I
it up out of
yet.
The way. Put it up high where she can't reach it.
Yeah. That's
I know, what but I, do I would mine. Need something that would be that high up because she's, like, long, dude. She's, like, like 2.5 feet
really?
Already.
Really?
Yeah, she comes up to my hip.
She's in that era, though, right now, where she's going to be everywhere no matter where you put
she'll
it.
She'll climb on something. Yeah, she'll pull over. She'll pull over, like, a stool or something. This is what she does.
Well,
if she can't get to something,
hold.
She'll bring something over to just climb on top of it.
Yeah.
So I can't, like, it just doesn't make any sense for me right now to.
Because she'll, even if you put it up where she can't reach it, she'll pull a chair over.
Trust me.
Like, she'll find a way.
When I look on your Facebook page and I'm like, oh my God, that's really nice. I would love to have that.
Yeah. I know.
And I'm like, wait a second. My daughter would destroy that.
Yeah.
Well, you'll just have to wait till the timing's right.
Right, man. So absolutely.
I will.
It'll fly by, dude.
I don't want it to fly by, though. I'm having fun with it right now. Yeah. So
it was a while ago I saw at your shop, man, you had an old Atari system.
Yeah. Sometimes we come across those.
Yeah, he had a really good find. Our boy Nichols, like, he went crazy over it. He was calling people multi-state.
Did you have the games and stuff, too?
Yep.
Yeah, man.
Was it all, like, one package? Like, you'd have, like, the games go with the, with the system?
Sometimes.
That's what I love about walking in your shop, man, because I never know what I'm going to find.
Right, because you never know what people are going to bring by.
Yeah.
So will you actually buy old video game systems from people as well?
Oh, yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
So
and I'm not talking like GameStop where it's like, you know, Xbox 360 stuff. This is like Nintendo.
Vintage gaming.
Yeah.
Well, I think we were talking a couple of weeks ago. I was looking into getting one of those Nintendo Minis,
and then I
didn't realize that was like a limited edition. So, like, if you're gonna get one of those, you're gonna pay like about $300.
I didn't know. You can
find them out and about.
I didn't know they only made so many of the Minis. Yes.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, you can find them out and about.
They made the little Nintendo Mini, and then they made the little Super Nintendo Mini.
Yeah,
but they were all like a limited.
Then there's a Sega Genesis one, and I think there's a PlayStation one
as
well.
That'd be cool.
Right?
I've been playing the shit out of some old school Sonic the Hedgehog at my house.
You know, fun fact, Michael Jackson actually wrote the Sonic the Hedgehog music. He composed the music for the first game.
That's crazy.
Right?
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
That's crazy, man. I know that theme song in my head.
That's Michael Jackson. We're all going to sit here now. Yeah.
But there's like a secret message inside, and it's like, I touch little boys.
Oh, I'm Michael Jackson.
Spread your cheeks.
Come to Neverland. Oh.
Did you ever watch the Michael Jackson documentary, James?
No, I didn't.
Oh, my God.
Don't watch it.
It's a tough watch, and then afterwards you hear him on the radio, and you're like,
Yeah.
So last night on HBO Max, Sarah's like, we should watch a new documentary, so we picked out Woody Allen.
Yeah.
Woody Allen, and it's a four-parter.
Yep.
That dude is a scumbag.
Absolutely. Have you made it all the way through?
No, I only watched one episode last night.
Yeah.
So, like, after the episode was over, I'm like,
creep.
God, I have to watch three more of those.
Yeah.
Because once you're in it, you have to finish it, right?
Right.
Yeah.
So,
it's like Tiger King.
There was a couple times where
Tiger King.
I was talking to myself out loud, and I was like, that piece of shit. I would wring that little pencil neck, little fucker's neck.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, I mean, it's weird.
Sarah's like,
that
calm
whole
down.
Situation,
calm
right?
Down.
Like, he's hanging out with adopted kids. I don't know what he's doing.
And he has that, like, annoying, like, New York accent, like, hi, my name's Woody.
Didn't he, like, teach?
Short little nerd.
Well, he's currently married to one of his daughters.
Yeah,
right?
his stepdaughter.
Korean. Yeah, she's Korean.
Soon-yi,
yeah.
I think that sounds Soon-yi? Better.
So she like was that, the oldest of the adopted children.
Right, right.
And so.
That's weird.
Well, last night's episode basically ended with, like, Mia went to his apartment without him being there, and she was just there, like, dropped something off. But on his desk, by his telephone, there were Polaroids of, what was her name?
Soon-yi.
Soon-yi. Mm-hmm. There was, like, pornographic pictures of her. Like, it was kind of like, She said on the documentary it resembled Hustler videos, Hustler photos.
Right.
So they were like raunchy because we all know like Hustler magazine. It's not like Playboy. Like Playboy is more glamorous.
So I was gonna say so they weren't airbrushed out. Yeah. Right. She like, took the time to like scrutinize these.
Hustler's a little more sexual and like nasty,
raunchy.
And that's what she said. It resembled a Hustler pose.
Wow.
And this
that's why he probably married her.
This was, she was like 13,
that's nuts.
14. And so she confronted him about this and he's like, I love her. He basically came out and was like, I love her.
At 13.
And she couldn't believe it.
Cool.
But this is the story though. Like the one of the youngest, her name's Dylan. Dylan Ferris, right?
Yeah. Or Farrow.
Farrow, I'm sorry. Dylan Farrow. She was like 5 or 6. And this scumbag would like just give her all his attention. It was like just blatantly obvious that this dude was like out with like some kind of weird like.
Yeah, he had a weird
connection with her. Like, so weird. Like there were certain times where like Mia would just kind of come in and she was like, this little girl was like touching his penis through his pants. But like he slapped her hand away like when Mia walked in. Mm-hmm. And he goes, oh, she was touching my penis. Why the fuck do you think she was doing that? Because you trained her to do that, you child molesting piece of shit.
But it's like all those guys with power,
right?
And in the industry, they just—it's
the—it's the Weinstein thing.
Yeah, they just—I guess they assume they can get away.
So they have
with
more
it,
money; or, they can just get away with certain things like child molestation.
I guess so. The list goes on and on and on.
I think a lot of that shit is finally starting to catch up with a lot of those guys, though.
Like these guys need to be hung.
I think the culture's finally starting to catch up with those guys. Like we're finally like, because the Weinstein thing was not a secret.
Right.
Like a lot of those women that he did stuff with, like in their contracts, they had money set aside in case they would sue him.
Right.
For stuff like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, they knew about it ahead of time. Yeah. So it's just now we just as a collective society are like, no.
Yeah, Weinstein got away with it for too long.
Way too
long. OJ got away with it because he's just...
He's OJ. Yeah, I mean, he had Johnny Cochran, right?
He had Johnny Cochran, and the glove didn't fit, so you must have quit.
You must have quit.
Bill Cosby. That was nuts.
And that was another kind of like open
secret. The Cosby
secret.
Cocktail. Yep.
Right.
Everybody knew about Bill Cosby.
Would you like a beverage?
But how many women? I mean...
It was like, wasn't it some comedian?
It was a ridiculous amount.
I mean, how many pudding pops did that guy go through?
Ooh, pudding pops.
Would you like to try my pudding pop, huh? Theo,
well, what was funny is right before that, he was doing a tour basically like criticizing black culture. And then here he was doing all this.
Doing what he was doing.
Yeah,
because he had the whole book, the fatherhood book that he wrote, all about being a great father.
Right, going out, doing these great big things and yelling at crowds.
Yeah, but
of black
I grew
men.
Up watching The Cosby Show.
Everybody did.
So, and I loved it.
Me too.
And then, when it happened, you're like, no way. Yeah.
Right?
There's no way. Yeah.
Cliff Clavin.
America's
Huxtable.
Dad.
Cliff Clavin.
Cliff Huxtable.
Who's Cliff Huxtable? Clavin?
No, he was in
Cliff
Cheers.
Cliff Clavin was from Cheers.
Yeah,
right.
He was the mailman.
Got your Cliff.
Sorry, let me just hold on 1 second.
Got you.
There you go. You earned it.
you earned it. Let's go ahead and mark it.
Yeah, but like he was like the all American father, right? Like, like in the Cosbys, he was a doctor. He had this beautiful uptown row home.
Oh, yeah. The show was awesome.
Just colonial brick house.
Yeah.
The ideal family, family values. And here this guy was
drugging
chicks. The direct opposite his entire career.
Right.
Drugging vulnerable women.
Who would have ever thought? Who would have ever thought?
Now he's in prison, dying.
I think the same people said the same thing when they found out Liberace was gay. But really, I mean, looking back, you're like, man, how did you not know that?
How did you not catch that?
That guy was wearing capes, high heels.
Well, Batman wears a cape.
Well, maybe we should talk about Batman.
Batman and Robin.
He likes to keep
Superman.
Young boys around.
Yeah,
I
didn't even think about it.
Don't judge me because I wear a cape. Capes are back, man.
How convenient. God, I hope capes.
Could you imagine
never come
if like
back.
Capes just came into style and we're all like walking around with a fucking cape on?
Oh God!
There's things we do that make less sense than that.
Dave,
nobody questions.
Yo, where'd you get that cape at, dude? It's fucking rad as shit.
Oh, I got it on. I got it at TJ Maxx. Sorry, my kids watch a TV program called PJ Masks.
I was just gonna say you've been watching too much kids shows.
So I got PJ Masks confused with TJ.
Was that
Maxx.
A new COVID show that they're watching?
No, just like PJ Masks been out for a while.
Okay. Yeah, it's like a little kid's animated superhero show.
And they're like a cat, a dog, yeah, a whole bunch of crap.
Your daughter will be watching
it. Oh, God, my kids watch that.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah.
Let's take a break.
All right.
That's some thumping bass there. Pull that down a bit there, Dave.
I got you.
There you go.
For all you old 77ers out there, don't forget to check out Last Flight Brewing Company right there on Heisinger Road in Jefferson City. It's an outdoor seating place. You can bring your kids, your dogs. They make their own beer. They have growlers.
Yeah, go growlers. Get yourself a growler. I need to do that.
You can refill your growler, depending on what beer it is. One's 15, one's 20. And just a cool place to hang out on a nice sunny day, man. That's I can't wait to do that. I've been there once, but I haven't been back. But I do have 3 growlers.
Nice.
And I finished all the beer. And it was all good.
That's the important part. Yeah.
I love it. He finished all the beer. I got all the beer finished.
That's the important part.
Also, check out In the Groove. We have Jamie here. He's the owner.
New location, 708 Jefferson Street.
That's right.
Officially open on
April 19th.
Yeah.
That's a Monday.
Okay.
So nice. In the Groove is it's amazing. It's nostalgic.
Give them a check.
Great vibe.
Man.
Check them out on Facebook, man. No matter where you're at in the world, if you're in Russia or if you're in Ireland, Spain,
Ireland, yes.
Hey, California.
Yep.
Hey, Jamie can send stuff to you. Absolutely. He doesn't hate on international. Nope. You know, he's a man of the world.
Absolutely. I can do it. He's a very cultured man.
Hit him up.
That's right.
All right, folks.
We'll be back right after this.
We'll see you next time. Not next time.
We'll be back,
you know,
Dave.
Like on the other side of the break. Of
calm down, Dave. Damn.
So this is the new Hurricane. Hoo-wee. Glad it's on our side, Hondo.
Tracker here. Assemble masks. Intruder closing in.
It's a venom stinger. Look out! Hurricane engage.
Vehicles each sold separately, with a figure.
Firefly heading for the sky.
Mask, where illusion is the ultimate weapon.
I'm getting out of here!
Mask, Hurricane, Firefly, and Stinger. Each sold separately. New from Kenner.
And welcome back to the old 77. It's a safe place.
In an unsafe world.
Back for the cool down.
The cool down.
Segment 3.
Back with Jamie.
Of episode 47.
Yeah, this is 47 of the old 77. We've been around a bit. We're coming up on our first year. It's in May, I believe. I'll have to check that out.
Yeah, because we thought that we were at a year before, but that was because...
I couldn't read my handwriting.
We had a bunch of episodes in the can, so we were like kind of behind where we thought we were.
There was a good time there where we had about 6 weeks in the can.
Mm-hmm.
And so we could skip a week or two. Mm-hmm. And it worked out because we got really busy at work for a bit.
Yeah. Hopefully, you know, now that things are slowing down.
Yeah, we can maybe get a couple going for next year, too.
Maybe we can get a couple in the can, yeah, especially since I'm going to be gone in a couple weeks.
Oh, that's right. Dave's taking the big trip.
Going to Colorado. Nice.
I do like staying, like...
taking the fam. That'll be nice.
I do like staying kind of more relevant, though. Like,
yeah.
Because we've been doing it very close to our distribution date. And it's just,
right.
We're not too far off where it's like something's
old.
I'm
not saying get, like, you know, 2 months out.
Right.
Nothing
like
that.
Like, before we were, what?
Oh,
4 weeks away.
6 weeks. Yeah, we had 6 weeks.
We were talking about something, and then you would hear.
I remember,
you know,
we
our
talked
Halloween
about
episode, and
we tried not
November.
To talk about the election, and then we finally just broke down and talked about the election, and it aired 3 weeks after the election.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, like this episode will come out next Tuesday.
Tuesday.
Right. Tuesday.
So
Tuesday.
It's everything's pretty well current, up to date now.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And I suppose we could do that in the future when we do have extra episodes in the can. We could can some episodes that
absolutely.
That aren't
we're
necessarily
to...
talking about like super current events. And then if we want to talk about some current events, we can bump one up in the rotation if we need to. Who knows, man? We don't know what we're doing.
I was going to say, this show is just totally winging it.
Yeah, we don't know what we're
doing. This is the ultimate water cooler chat at work. Hey, what are you doing this weekend? I don't know.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
No, what are you doing?
Right, pretty much.
What are you going to do?
What are you going to do this
weekend?
Did you
weekend, hear those Danny? Fucking idiots talking about some shit that they even don't talk
pretty
about?
Pretty much it right there.
They just said this thing and then that thing and they led to something else.
You're these morons over here.
All right, guys. So we were talking about how people from our generation are like buying up old stuff that reminds us of our childhood He-Man stuff and old video games.
Castle Grayskull.
So I don't know if you guys saw this, but an old copy of Super Mario Brothers, the original one for the NES system.
Like that came out with the original?
Yes.
Yeah. Unopened, right?
Yeah, unopened. This guy had it. Like, I think he got it as a Christmas gift or something, and just it stayed in his drawer.
So he was like 13 when he got it. He's like, I'm not gonna play this.
Maybe he forgot about it. I was gonna
say, what 13-year-old doesn't want to play that?
Yeah, he's gonna like just maybe this is what happened. He got the NES. Super Mario Bros. came with it, but then like someone maybe bought him
an extra copy.
A copy, and he just kept it wrapped
up. That's possible.
I don't know, man.
Or maybe he's just very disciplined.
Do you guys want to take a guess at how much that copy of Super Mario Brothers sold for?
$1 million.
A little lower. As he pets the cat.
Yeah. It's a little lower than that.
Just a little?
I mean, you know. $1 million is a lot of money.
Well, I mean, $1 million is $1 million.
Yeah.
So what are we talking like?
What would you do with $1 million? Two chicks, one time.
Two chicks at the same time.
What's the one guy? Hookers and blow?
Yeah.
We have a friend who says that all the time. Hookers and blow. He was on the show, friend of the show.
Okay, so it was $660,000.
Good Lord.
Mm-hmm. Somebody recently paid $156,000 for a pristine copy of Super Mario Brothers 3.
Wow.
Wow.
So,
wow.
And I also remember reading about this same auction. Somebody paid a ton of money.
That's a rich nerd.
Yeah. Somebody paid a ton of money for like one of the original issues of Mike Tyson's Punch-Out, too. It was in the hundreds of thousands that somebody paid for that, too.
I would have never imagined.
That was my game back in the day, man.
That was awesome.
That was a great game back in the day.
Still a great game.
Dave talks about it like he remembers being like having nightmares of fighting Tyson.
Yeah, I beat Tyson one time, and I never played it again.
Set it down and walked away.
Never played it again.
He took it out. He's like, fuck you, game.
Went in the bathtub, cried.
That was a good game.
He's like, I own you.
That game was so hard.
It was.
You had to find everybody's tells. Yep.
Everybody had tells. They'd blink or they'd wink or they'd do some weird shit with their hands.
Oh, yeah.
I just remember like mowing through each fighter and then getting to Mike and getting knocked out.
Oh, yeah.
Every time. Yeah. I'm like, damn, he's tough.
And then you got tired of it, so you went out and you found the code. You went straight to Mike.
0073-5963.
Dave still has it in his memory.
Right. Yeah. Up, up, down, down.
I got a few codes still stuck up in my brain. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mortal Kombat was my game. That was really my game. The original Mortal Kombat. That was my shit.
So what was your system back in the day? Everybody was like Sega.
I was a Nintendo guy.
Yeah.
Me too, man. I was a Nintendo guy.
I was Nintendo at first, and then I transferred over to Sega Genesis.
Yeah, I had a neighbor that had a Genesis, so I...
Sega was great. Was awesome. I loved...
Yeah, for sure.
I loved Sega games. And
they looked better.
Yeah.
And then
I
switched over to PlayStation from Sega.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. PlayStation.
And then I had PlayStation throughout. And then, you know, for quite some time, I didn't have a video... Well, I had PS3.
Yeah.
But then I had PS3 forever. Then I just didn't bother. But then...
Yeah. I was there for a little
then
bit.
Then when Sarah and I after we got married, I bought an Xbox One.
Mm-hmm. That's what I have now.
Yeah. And then I got the smart TVs, and I'm like, well, you know, Xbox One now we just use for, like, Blu-rays and shit.
Right.
Yeah. It's delegated to the Blu-ray.
Like,
poor
I really
thing.
Don't... Like, look, I tried playing video games before.
I can't
like,
play.
Like,
I can't
when
play
I was a kid,
games.
I was a video game head.
Me too. They're different now, though.
I can't play them.
And, like, I told you guys, like, I was an amazing Madden player. Like, if I would have stayed with Madden all these years, I'd be playing in these tournaments, like,
right.
dominating
right.
these little kids.
Making money.
Making all
just,
kinds
like,
of
making
money.
Right. Yeah, making money. Like, I was the man, dude. Like, no one could beat me in Madden. I was amazing. I'm not trying to toot my own horn. Doo-doo. I'm just saying I had game. I had game.
Yeah.
I would whoop any of these dudes today.
I
feel like if I had time and came back and trained in Madden...
Yeah,
that I can get back to that level.
I
want to
see you and
domination,
Dave rolling up into the arcade, like taking dudes' sandwiches, eating them, throwing them back on. Just
I'll
like
be the Mortal Kombat
in.
Guy. You
I'd
can be
like,
the Madden guy.
Tuna
right?
fish on rye. What the hell is this shit?
Get out of here!
But it's my sandwich.
But no, I took off for a very long time, and then I tried to get back into it. Mm-hmm. So like, I have a group of friends who like do a lot of. Team games like, you know...
Like online play?
Yeah, so like...
Call of Duty, stuff like that.
Stuff like that. And I tried to get back into it, and just... I just don't have time.
Me neither. Yeah.
I've been playing Fortnite with my boy, and that is so weird. Yeah. Right?
Is your boy like way better at it than you
no,
are?
No, he's terrible. You know what? Oh, so okay. That helps.
Right.
That
you helps. Know what's funny about that game though, Scott? Fortnite. So like you see all these kids doing all these different dances and shit. I'm like, yeah. Where'd you get that from? Like Fortnite.
Yeah.
Really?
So apparently all these characters like dance, have a certain dance moves.
Yeah,
so
like when you select
there's actual
character.
Artists that they've released entire concerts during the pandemic in Fortnite.
What?
Like Post Malone put on a concert what? In Fortnite.
Yeah, like it was like a video game Post Malone, like
yeah.
playing guitar. He was like this avatar
yeah.
Post
yeah,
Malone.
It would be like his avatar within the game, and then you would all show up wherever he is in the game, and that's where they would have a concert.
He had all the tattoos all over.
Oh, I'm sure. But, you know, it probably popped up with, like, video, but that's how they're starting to right, sell that right, stuff right. now.
Interesting.
Another one I thought was really weird is for the Switch, they have Animal Crossing. People were doing funerals during the pandemic in Animal Crossing.
What?
So they would like they would make little groups that everyone could like come to this island and they would have a funeral there.
That's because, so weird.
Because
right?
nobody weird. Could so go weird. Out and weird. Do any of it anymore.
Oh.
Bizarre.
It is. This pandemic was so strange and so weird. It's going to completely change the way our futures roll from
it
here
already
on out.
Shifted things.
Right.
You know?
Oh, forever.
And if you look at it, you know,
I'm tired of wearing a face panty. I just want to say that.
Yeah, so am I.
God, I'm tired
there
of that.
Is this whole like cyber video game world now, where like if you interview, like you see like a lot of these gamers being interviewed. They have like their like
oh, they're rock stars now.
Yeah. They're like rock stars, yeah. And they talk about these games like they played at the actual game.
I know I didn't realize that till my nephew told me about it, but I didn't realize they make like hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Yes.
Oh God, yes,
big what? Money.
Right, playing a video game.
Yeah,
I had no idea till
there's these tournaments.
A few months ago.
There's big money involved. There's sponsorships.
And then there's just the guys.
All
on
this e-gaming going on now. There's right. billions of dollars involved with all this.
Well, Fortnite's a big one. Like at the end of the
is.
Year last
it
year,
is.
They gave it's away $20 million.
Yeah.
What?
Right.
So just imagine how much money they made.
And that was,
yeah.
lower, that was a
that
lower.
That
was a lower end tournament. You know, there's some others like Dota and some other games that are giving away like $200 million.
It's insane, dude.
It's a ridiculous amount of prizes that they're giving away.
And we're just talking about like tournaments. We're not even talking about the guys that stream on Twitch and have millions of viewers that are just
they
making
make tons
money.
Of money.
Oh,
millions.
Yeah. By influencing.
Millions a
year. So today I was on Twitch at work just to check things out from where we work at.
Right.
And there was a Tampax commercial. And there was like five different women with like testimonials, but it was like it was like a 30-second commercial, but it was like five different women like sharing the lines, like they would talk, but they're all in like the same sentence.
Yeah,
it's like they cut it up differently,
right? Uh-huh. Right.
And they were talking about like tampons and shit, and I would imagine that's a huge market there. There's we have a kid who was on here, well, Jacob,
okay,
he was a guest of ours two shows ago, and his girlfriend is
she's
a huge
influencer.
Gamer.
Yeah,
she's an influencer.
Yeah.
What?
She makes money being an influencer.
Yeah.
And this on this gaming
I
on this gaming
crazy
this gaming stage.
I think she makes money playing games and people follow her.
Yeah.
And if she can promote like whatever, like say the whoever makes
nuts,
this cup,
dude.
Right?
It's,
she
it's
can do
nuts.
Like a 10-second live read or whatever. She get paid for that.
Yeah.
That's pretty
nuts.
Cool though.
That's super
it's
cool.
Nuts,
and she's doing it from
cool.
the comfort of her her little area.
It's not, but it's cool.
Yeah.
Guys, we were way ahead of our time. Yeah. I feel like we were limited by our technology.
Yeah,
absolutely.
When my dad told me when I was a kid, when I was getting so anyway, I got a funny story for you.
Okay.
When I first got my NES, I was in sixth grade, right? And I would play the shit out of my Nintendo. And my grades came down bad. So I had like an F in like English or something because like I just never did my homework. And I basically signed my all my homework and all my stuff, like all my test results were I basically like signed my mom's name and stuff. And I would just it would just never get home.
Mom ever
so
signed anything they'd swear.
I forged everything. And so they had like a I did so bad. Like my dad had to go up there and go for a parent teacher conference thing. And he comes back and he's like,
Big Jim Francis.
He takes the Nintendo and he puts it away and he's like, you've been playing too much of this shit. You got to get your grades up. And he's like, you're failing English. How the hell do you fail the language you speak? And I'm like,
right.
I was like, I know, Dad. And you look back at that If he would have just kept playing, I might have been like one of these like multi-million dollar fucking gamers right now.
No, you were too early, bro.
Too early.
No, you wouldn't.
Damn you, Jim.
Yeah.
Your kids, maybe. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because like when I came home and I during the pandemic, I pitched esports where we work. And my kid found out about it. And he's like, you mean I can make money doing this? And so that's what he wants to do now.
See, that's cool, though. That's actually maybe a...
I mean,
it's a career path.
I got him the software. He's playing with it. He's working on it.
Is it Minecraft that he does?
He does Minecraft. He's big into Roblox.
Yeah, my kids have started playing Roblox.
Roblox is a big one. It's basically an online like game that you can go play. It's open world. You can do whatever you want.
Yeah.
They have different little side quests. Like if, say, like there's a door over here and it's always shut, right? And all of a sudden one day it's open and you go in there and you run through something, then you can get cash in the game.
Mm.
Right? And if you get enough cash, you can spend it within the game. Or you can buy the cash for the game. That's where they get you. So you need 30 Robux, right?
Yeah.
That's $5.
Right.
You know. Or you can win it within the game.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I'm that horrible parent that won't get my kid, so he's got to go find all these side quests. He's a friggin' millionaire because he's found tons of stuff.
It's a serious business now.
Right.
It's a billion-dollar business.
It's growing.
Tons of sponsorships. It's just going to get bigger.
It's the only business, really, year after year after year, that has considerably leaped.
Yeah.
I've been following it for about 5 years now, and every year for 5 years, it's jumped by 15%.
Mm-hmm.
What other business model does that?
Mm. Right.
They're projected to make almost $12 billion this year with esports. Mm.
Yeah, that's crazy. We're at a point in time, gentlemen, where like things are about to really get weird because it's not going to be that much longer where these video games are basically going to be indistinguishable from actual reality.
I mean, is it heading towards like that movie Ready Player One? Have you seen it?
Yeah, I've seen it.
Mm-hmm. Like everything's basically like people just jump on their virtual reality and you're in this other world.
Yeah, all day long.
I think it will be eventually. But it, like that show, so they have this like a trampoline that they stand on, so they can walk. They've got like treadmills, they've got haptic feedback suits, all that stuff is coming out.
Mm-hmm.
I just saw a thing the other day. It's a thing like Peloton that you can get for your house, and you pay so much money for it, and it's literally like that. You get a haptic suit, like a vest, so if somebody punches you in the game, you feel it.
You feel it. Wow.
Right. It's got a headset. You can turn on it because it's got a ball that you can move around, so you can walk and just keep walking.
Yeah,
you know, like the porn like of part
course.
Of it.
Oh, those guys are all over.
No,
it.
I'm honest.
Of course.
Like, honestly, there is going to be a huge market for porn in VR, dude. Yeah.
Well, honestly, I feel sorry for prosties because once robots come in,
damn,
you know,
all
it's all legal.
Yeah.
At that point,
prostitutes and truck drivers.
What was it? Our friend Goody always said we were talking one day. He brought up the fact that in Sweden they have some brothel and it's all robots, and he's like, what is that all about? No. I said something against it. He was like, what are you, a robophobe or something?
That's pretty good.
Yeah, that sounds like,
yeah, a robophobe, you know.
I don't know if that's a word, but if it's not, it definitely needs to be a word like now.
But I mean, the world that we're leaving for our kids is going to be so different than what we had.
We didn't have the internet.
No, thank God.
Cell phones.
Oh, my God.
Yeah,
I'm so glad I did all my running around and stupid shit before that.
Me too. I just explained to my kids yesterday how cell phones were not a thing when daddy was your age.
When dad was out bashing something with a baseball bat, you know, I'm not going to say what.
I didn't have to worry about any hidden cameras.
No, I didn't have to do any of that.
Cell phone pictures or
thank God.
Any of that shit.
Because we had this one mailbox that was called the Tank. Just saying.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Was it hard to bash over?
The dude, he kept putting it up. We'd take it down. And then it became a thing. And then he like encased it in concrete. Yeah, it was a good time.
I have a couple neighbors whose mailboxes are encased in concrete. Because I live out in the boonies.
Yeah,
like my mailbox right now has a big gash right in the middle of it. Yeah. It does, but mine's pretty sturdy. They haven't been able to knock it down
yet.
But that's why you don't spend too much money on a mailbox when you live out in the country.
Well, not when you live out there.
No, because you know that thing's going to be down before too.
I mean, come on, probably. Mm-hmm.
That's the way they roll out in the country, man. It's a whole other world out there.
It's crazy, man.
Whole other world.
I mean, everything is going virtual, and we're going to end up just like that movie.
You think so?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, look at all this like VR equipment I'm looking up. It's expensive as hell.
But it won't be.
Just the fact, though, that they have it.
It's, you got the VR Cosmos Elite VR headset bundle with two tracks and track belt. It's like $1,100.
Oh, is that it?
They can have it.
It'll all go down in price, just like everything else.
I'm sorry. How much is the new? How much is the new Xbox? Wasn't it like $1,000 almost?
Oh my god!
Look at this shit.
I think the PS5 was too.
The Live Planet 360 3D VR camera professional, whatever the fuck that is. 16 camera audio in.
Eight grand.
Is that the thing you stand on?
I would imagine so.
Wow.
Because the thing I saw, it was just like Ready Player One. You stand on this thing.
Maybe this is it.
What?
Oh, no, that's a camera.
That's a camera.
That's a camera.
Yeah.
Wow.
But that's nuts.
$8,000.
That's a whole different VR world right there. Like a whole entire planet.
Dude, you have to
probably go swimming in a VR world and jump off an airplane.
You have to just be filthy rich to drop that kind of money on something like that, though, because I guarantee you, just like every other kind of technology, like in a year, there will be something out that's way better, and that thing you spent $8,000 on is now...
I feel like all this stuff will be cheaper someday because it'll be more prevalent.
But those people like being the first to have... I was the first one to have it, you know? Right.
That's what it's all about.
Yeah, it is.
I mean, if you think about it, you guys remember the first person you ever saw who had a VCR?
Right.
It's the same thing there, too.
Like, this one here is $15,000. That's just as much as a car.
Yeah, that's a down payment on a Ford Focus.
That is a Ford Focus,
that's a down payment on a house.
Yeah.
$15,000.
Yeah, I'll wait until this shit comes down in price, and then maybe we'll talk. I don't know, though, man. It's just... Things are going to get really, really weird.
Things are weird right now.
Oh, yeah. They're definitely going to get weird.
Locally, talking about weird, dude, did you hear about this in Jefferson City? The Attorney General's office filed a lawsuit today against...
Was that today?
Last week. I'm sorry. Beg my pardon. Against Blue Loftus Asian Massage... It's a... basically a massage parlor right there on Southwest and Stadium.
Yes.
Oh, I know the one you're talking about.
Matt used to live by the place.
Two houses down. Two places down. Right. Not even like 25 feet over. There's it was under new ownership.
I haven't heard this.
So
I haven't
heard that either. Being filed a lawsuit because of illicit massage business. Illicit touching.
Yeah.
They were
$50 get you anything. Yep.
Reviews from different massage boards were included that described sex acts performed on the premises.
You know, I've always wanted to go get a massage, but I've always been afraid to go get a massage.
But driving by there, sometimes you would see three or four cars out in front of there. What's going on here?
I mean, there's a line out the door.
Apparently, they were advertised. They advertised their services on shady websites similar to the old... Backpage.com.
Or like Craigslist. Yeah.
Backpage.
Yeah. You know, I drive by that place. It's like right by where I work.
Drive by it now.
Yeah, it's right by where I teach. And it's funny because when I'm at that stoplight, I look at that place. And I'm like, I wonder if they give handies in there.
So basically, they were on these apps. It was called Skip the Games, Rub Maps.
That sounds like a worthwhile app.
Harlot Hub, Rub Ratings. iBackpage are the listed websites.
We knew something was had to be going on.
They shut down four places in Missouri.
Right.
Apparently, they were offering handies for $50.
I was right. Yay!
And also letting the customers fill up the ladies.
Whoa.
Fill up the ladies?
Yeah, so this is what they're being.
Oh, fill up the ladies.
This is what they're.
Matt's got that X.
This is what they're doing, man.
So did they shut that place down?
They
would have had to.
I mean, I would think they're shut down right now.
Yeah, probably.
I mean, if you have charges against you for...
There's a dentist. Basically there's a dentist office right next door to that place, too.
It's downstairs, I believe.
That's my wife's dentist. That's where my wife goes to the dentist.
So there's the massage place is upstairs, and then the downstairs is the dentist place. Because there's two parking lots.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, like, when we lived there, I believe it was something else. It was some kind of doctor's office.
Yeah.
And that was just
I remember being 5 years
ago.
Office.
That was 5 years ago.
Yeah. That's
but
funny,
so when we moved in over there on Veith,
yeah.
We would always drive by and it was like always like Christmas lights hanging up. It was like
But
it was kind of like
they
that setting
that location,
right?
Like hidden in plain sight type thing, or yeah.
maybe I mean
like
Southwest
maybe they were thinking, oh, we'll be here and nobody will figure us out.
I mean, right?
Yeah, I mean, you know how busy it gets on Southwest yeah. And Stadium.
I mean, that's a very busy intersection.
Yeah,
there's always people there.
But oh, apparently, yeah. they're giving out handies in that place. Yeah. There's a bunch of
bringing them in for miles.
One
man.
Of our friends, guest of the show, was very upset that he didn't get to go in there.
Yeah.
That's well, a good question now. Do you roll up in there like, here you got handy?
Yeah. Hey, are you guys still open?
Yeah. I'm really horny right now.
I got
now.
$50 and it's burning a hole yeah. in my pocket.
That's the thing that like...
Hey, man, I just got my stimmy. Come on.
Speaking of the hole in my pocket.
I just got $1,400, motherfucker.
Thank you, Uncle Stimmy.
Thank you, Uncle Joe.
Yeah, the whole thing with Asian massage part, like it just... I guess I'm just not the type of guy that's going to walk into a massage parlor and be like, yo, by the way, can you give me a handy? I guess I'm just not that guy. Because, like, I would be afraid of rejection. Yeah. I would yeah, be like, yeah. I would. They would be like, no, of no. course we don't give handies
yeah,
here.
Like, oh, I, yeah.
Yeah, I would feel so bad.
But these apps are funny, man. Like, skip the games, rub maps.
Well, rub maps is great.
Rub ratings.
You know right down here there used to be a...
Yes.
Right here.
Yes. Yeah, just right there at the end of the
that
road.
That was crazy in itself.
Yeah, we talked about this on previous episodes.
Oh, really?
The porn shop that used to be down at the end yeah. of the road.
Yeah.
It was like one of the first ones in
yeah,
Jeff City,
but it was
too.
Just a house.
And it was
yeah.
named like, after his daughters. He like yeah. combined
oh,
their name.
Oh, God.
Which is even more creepier.
One. And girls, I guess, would strip in the basement.
That's what ended up getting him like shut down, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it turned into...
It's like
into,
the Wild West around here.
Right? It turned into a strip club, and it was supposed to be a sex shop in
Jamie,
a dude's basement.
Jamie, do you know the story of how he named that place?
Well, we just said it.
He combined, well, his, he combined his two daughters' names into one. I'm serious. No, really? like Shackle. So I can't remember. One was
maybe, it Shackles?
Shackle's Secrets is what it was called, but
oh
he had like one daughter.
I don't think I even knew what it was called.
Maybe it was like Shannon and yeah. Kelly, maybe?
That makes it even
and he
worse.
Combined,
oh,
he combined
wow.
his two daughters' names
that's insane.
To name his sex shop.
That's fucking
even,
prick.
That's even yeah, worse. Much. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, God.
Guys, I am on rubratings.com right now, and I have to say,
so it's not, it's closed down.
I'm going to go ahead and create a user profile, guys.
I don't see a problem with this. I'm glad you're using my internet for that.
Right. Hold on. Let me turn the
John
VPN
Doe.
On.
Right, right.
Is that
I got,
Irish?
I got the VPN.
Yes.
Hold on.
Yes, John. That's Jonathan Doe.
All right, now they think I'm in Sweden, so it's okay.
Right, right.
You made me rub my genitals on another man, and I have never done that before I met you.
Oh my God. That's terrible.
Actual audio from inside, from whatever that place was
yeah,
called.
Shackles.
Shackles.
Well, I was thinking of the of yeah. the massage parlor
oh,
place.
Oh, God, that's terrible
oh,
name.
Oh, man, I'm telling you. I mean, so it was called again. Let's see here. Where's that information at?
What are you trying to find? The name of the place? The name of the place?
No, that... he's trying to talk about the Blue Lotus,
yeah,
right?
The Blue Lotus. Lotus. That's
the
what
Blue
it
Lotus.
Okay.
What a name.
The Blue Lotus.
The Blue Lotus got caught.
They sure did.
Well, I'm going to definitely
They should have stayed blue.
Yeah. yeah.
So I wonder how like a place like that, I mean, if you're, how do they get caught? Does someone like report them?
Well, sure.
Like, does someone go in there and well, be like,
somebody
do
probably...
you give out hand jobs? Yes, we do. Okay, well, I'm going
to
report
you. Well, if
you
enough
now.
People in the city start questioning it and go to the attorney general and say, hey, what's going on?
Maybe,
they're
going
to investigate it.
Maybe. But yeah, it looks legit from outside.
I feel like the city would investigate that
yeah.
anyway.
Yeah.
It's right. like a health department
oh,
violation.
Maybe it is a health
yeah.
department. Yeah. Maybe there's like yeah. too much semen on the floor.
Right. Right.
Oh, God.
Like, by the way, why are these mats all sticky?
The dentist downstairs, like, there's a leak upstairs. I don't get it, man. Yeah.
We forgot to bleach last night. That's oh, why God. We got caught.
You're only allowed 2 milliliters of semen per gallon.
Per gallon.
You have far.
But, you know, I kind
of
wonder if it's like somebody did roll up in there and they were like, oh, would you like something
yeah
no.
maybe it was like a one of those undercover
that's
like,
what I was gonna say they probably sent an undercover guy
because
there.
That the there was a bar in Ellis and they were doing that there
yeah they were having like they had like a swingers club
yeah swingers club on yeah. Ellis
oh
and they
God,
got
I heard about
the
that.
Undercover cops caught them or something
the latest place that was up there
yeah
this
it's a liquor store now
yeah
it's a liquor
how long ago
store.
Was that
oh that's been
a
while
probably
oh.
close to 10 years
oh yeah maybe I wasn't here yet
yeah
So, like, it was... So, what happened?
It was
this?
Like a... They
it
turned
a
it
bar,
into a
it was
bar.
Like a pool hall or something.
Uh-huh.
And yeah, it was like and
people were. I guess people were in the back getting it on.
Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter who you are, they were getting it on.
So they would like roll up in there as a couple and then leave with other people, or they would like do all their business right there.
Yeah,
I think they had a back room that they were the doing stuff in. Yeah.
Oh my! Because
I think they. I even heard. I don't know if it's true, but like I think cops like drove by and like saw in there and saw stuff going on. Yeah. That's what I heard.
And that's how they got caught?
Yeah, I think so.
It's that damn club music.
Because they had the window open.
Yeah.
Well, leather gets hot, man. Come on.
It's hot here. Open something up. All you hear is moaning.
It's Missouri winter. Or Missouri summer.
Missouri summer.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's hot.
It's hot in here.
Well,
God
you take
it.
that damn leather helmet off, you'd probably be able to breathe.
Take the damn apple out of your mouth, Ronald.
She's not taking the turtle too well.
Oh, God. The cops actually saw him. Oh, man.
I'm surprised the cops, they just jump in and be like, hey.
I think it's funny, the first time I even mentioned to anyone where I was like thinking about moving, which was this house, and they were like, dude, there's a sex club at the end of your street. Even Angel said that the other day. Yeah, he was talking about it.
But it was never here. Like, it's not been here since you moved out here.
No.
It didn't last.
But it's funny.
It didn't last very long.
On the door, like the last person who had it, because it just sold, on the door, they had a D&D. And I was like, oh, it was their last name. Like, that's kinky.
That's hilarious.
I wonder if they even know. They got D on the door.
Whoops.
Seems a little sketchy to me, man.
I think the whole thing was sketchy, dude. You imagine walking up to some cat's house?
No.
And then just rolling in his basement?
Right.
I mean, any place that, like, is a brothel is going to be sketchy. I mean, even if you go to a strip club,
but in the
it's
basement,
still sketchy.
Yeah.
Right.
Next to the lawnmower.
They have older. Yeah.
Oh, and it's named after my daughters.
Yeah.
Hey, watch the tractor. It's a bit rusty on the seat.
Speaking of rusty trombones, those are $5 in the back.
My sister's giving those out. Oh,
stripper pole needs some WD-40.
Yeah. I mean, even if you go to a strip club, it's like black walls.
Right.
The black lights are on and shit. It's just like, this is sketch.
I've only
and
done...
And who's the DJ?
Right.
Good question.
KCMQ.
DJ Easy Dicks on the mic.
Yeah, KCMQ. Hey, turn on the radio. Turn on KCMQ and start dancing.
Sorry, guys. The show happens in another 5 minutes after this commercial break.
Yeah.
Maybe it's like the Christmas lights out at Binder where you turn into a certain radio station and everything's synchronized.
Yeah,
it's like a small radius.
To the beat.
Turn on 92.5.
Well, speaking of crazy and the whole thing, we were talking about down at the lake, too, not too long ago, the realtor down there that tried to kill her mother-in-law.
Yeah.
Dave,
yeah.
You have all that info. Like, the
That's
mayor's
crazy.
In it.
Crazy.
Yeah, like, now Leanne. There's more to that now?
Well, apparently. Is there more? Maybe I haven't heard it.
Murder for hire?
I thought you had more to it with the mayor now.
Yeah, the mayor's like a sleazebag.
The mayor's a sleazebag.
Yeah, there's another story to it.
Yeah, I had that whole article printed out, and I don't know what I did with it.
I don't remember.
Basically, the mayor is like...
Wasn't he like banging 13-year-olds or underage girls?
He was basically preying on young girls that ended up in jail.
Oh my God.
And he would like... He would
what?
He would pay their bail, but he would expect something in return.
Oh my God, that's terrible.
And
that's
horrible. Dude, there's an article. It's on lakeexpo.com. There's a whole article about the dude. Now, we just had elections yesterday, and he lost.
Oh, did he? Good.
Yeah. Some
that's a shame.
Some write-in person. Yeah, right.
Who's going to get the young girls out of prison now?
There is hope down there.
Yeah, I guess so, man. Somebody that was a write-in won. So he's on his way out. But man, he was praying.
But he was like, apparently he was like really good friends with Leanne.
Him and Leanne were buddies. Like,
he tried to kill her mother-in-law. You heard about that, right?
Yeah, the murder for hire. Mm-hmm. But was it for like $1,500?
$1,500 bucks? Like that? Yeah. Like, what? Yeah. What?
You really hate her, don't you?
$1,500
bucks. I hate her on a budget.
Yeah. She just got her stimulus. She was like, it'll kill my mother-in-law.
Wow.
Yeah, she asked how much it would cost. And when they said $1,500, her response was, that's reasonable.
That's reasonable.
Yeah. What?
Okay, I'm sorry, but if I'm even thinking, if I'm even thinking about doing that, like, I'm not going to taint myself with $1,500.
No, I'm going to go for the high dollar assassination.
It's going to have to be $1,000.
So this house is a really nice 6,000. Living area, and this kitchen's a walk-in. And by the way, could you kill my mother-in-law for $1,500?
Right.
My favorite part is that
I can sell your home cheap.
My favorite part is that she's a newly converted Christian too,
of course. She is.
Like as she was talking to the hitman, she was like, my only concern is that I'm a Christian, But, you know, I'm just going to ask God for forgiveness. He'll understand.
Right. I mean,
they'll put her away for a long time.
Yeah, I have a feeling she's going to go away for a bit.
Yeah, she found Jesus, all right. Yeah, when the cops locked her up, she's like, oh, my God, I found Jesus. Yeah.
She's fixing to found a whole lot more than Jesus.
She's going
to,
yeah.
Help me, Jesus.
But Jesus will be in cell block 6.
Yeah, I can't wait to see how that whole thing shakes out.
$1,500.
Mm-hmm.
That makes me laugh every
and
single
time. I know, that's
she's,
the funny
she's such a weird number.
She could definitely afford way more than $1,500.
How do you come
to Peter first was in fear when Jesus told him to launch out. It's amazing when the Lord speaks to you.
Call me right now.
Farting creature is back.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's get the vows and all the prayer requests here. What time do we have? Two will see the glory of God.
Maybe this is the guy that can
Hallelujah.
Maybe.
And my word will not return void, and it will go to that which it was sent.
That's me in a prison. I hope you hear this.
She's not listening to us.
No.
She's still
I
locked
guarantee
up.
Guarantee that.
One of her friends will be like, guess what? Some guys are talking about you and Jefferson.
Hey, if we get a cease and desist, I'll be happy with that.
Me too.
You know, I'm good with that.
Absolutely.
Hey, Dave. Is that Dave Jordan from back in the day?
But oh, my God. She remembers you.
How stupid do you have to be? I mean, right. You have to be pretty stupid to think that that's going to happen for $1,500.
Like, hits are like half a mil.
Right. It's like... Like, it what? Doesn't even make a bit of sense.
You know, the whole time she was telling other people, like, I got a deal.
Yeah.
She's very frugal.
She really thinks high of her mother-in-law.
Right. Oh, God. Oh,
yeah. Well, I think she's got like 5 of them at this point.
Yeah, I was going to say she's been divorced a couple
times
in that
story.
She's been
married and divorced a few times.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, we had that story where it said she was divorced at least like 2-3 times.
The marriage was growing great until I met his mother.
Like, which mother did she want to kill? The current or like a former?
Yeah, like two mothers, right. Mother-in-laws ago.
It was a former.
Well, yeah. It was like two mother-in-laws ago
or
something,
right? It was one of the former,
They must have all ganged up on her and shit.
Okay, how shitty did that woman have to feel to know that she, you know, was a hit did
for
that,
$1,500.
Right?
$1,500.
Like,
bucks,
I would be more like, upset damn, and offended that that's all I was worth to you, right? I'm only worth $1,500?
I'd be mad. I'd go to Jeb, be like, I'd go visit her and Jeb, be like, why was it only $1,500?
I'd give her $5 each time. You need this more than I do.
But what state of mind do you have to be in to, first of all, want to murder someone? And then you're in a state of mind you're going to hire somebody to do it. And then you're going to go along and agree with the $1,500 price. And you're thinking about it. And what kind of mindset are you in?
I think she just thought she was untouchable because she was connected with the cops and
the
mayor and all of that. So
and nothing would happen.
I think she just didn't think that.
But in today's world and society with all the technology and the constant news and the constant stuff, you didn't
stop for one second
and think, hey.
No.
Oh.
That's what happens to people, though, when they get a taste of power.
Yeah.
They think they're untouchable. And she was a powerful person. At the lake.
Like in the real estate market, I would assume.
Yeah, I mean, in that world. But
yeah, you're right, Dave. She had a lot of connections. And if the mayor is, like, you know, on your cell phone favorites.
Yeah.
Or like
I hang out with the mayor.
I'm sure they banged.
People.
I'm sure.
Damn, this really went a step further.
I'm sure.
But don't they realize there's sheriffs and FBI agents and those people can go over the mayor's head.
Right, they're seriously watching you.
Yeah.
Did the feds get involved with this case or was it just the local police?
I was thinking it was fed too.
Yeah, I want to say the FBI got involved.
They would probably have to.
When you start like putting hits out on people, I think it's like FBI comes
I think
in.
That was the point where the FBI came in. I'm pretty sure.
And those agents are probably like, $1,500? Yeah. Oh, my God, lady.
I need to go. I try to Google her name like once every few days just to see if there's an update. I haven't done it.
I mean,
she's
probably looking at, what, 20 years?
Oh.
Oh, if not more.
Premeditated shit.
Yeah, but she's got money, so she'll be in there for 5 if she's
on good behavior.
Well, good behavior. I was going to say good behavior. She can get out. But
she'll
even
be selling
then,
houses in no time.
But she'll never be anything around locally.
No, she'd have to leave.
Yeah.
Yeah,
she'd have to leave this area.
Move to Arkansas where it's legal.
Yeah. I mean, so I just Googled her name and we've got articles from Washington Post.
Oh, yeah. This story got out.
Wow.
Yeah.
From
this story got out.
Which is a pretty
They'll make a movie about it.
Oh, yeah, it'll be
starring Jason Bateman.
Netflix original.
Netflix original.
At the very least, we'll get like a 2020 special or like a 48-hour special.
Yeah. Tori Spelling is Leanne Bowman.
Yeah, we got to think about who would play her. I don't know.
Tori Spelling. Tori Spelling.
I say Tori Spelling's a good one, man. Yeah.
She probably would be all right. Yeah.
Sharon Dottery.
So,
someone crazy.
And she's pretty. She's so pretty.
Especially in that mugshot.
The movie's going to be called...
It looked like she'd been crying in that mugshot.
Yeah.
The movie's going to be called When I Got My Stimulus.
So...
That's a good one.
Throw Mama from the Train.
She was a babe back in the day, man.
$1,500.
But it just goes to show you, no matter how successful, how rich you are, how pretty you are.
Yep. Right.
It's all a... It can all be a facade. It's fake.
Right.
She's totally fake.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Well, that was going to make
her
happy.
Fake, right?
Killing mother-in-law. Yeah. That was going to make her happy. So.
Wow.
You know.
It just goes to show you, man, that like some of the people that on the outside you would think would be the happiest, people that have a ton of money.
Oh, right. God, no.
Most of those people are miserable.
They are miserable.
Money doesn't bring happiness.
No, it clearly doesn't.
I think we all know that. All of us know that here, you know.
That's because we're all basically poor.
Yeah. Right.
You know, it's funny how that is. Yeah. We were talking about that the other day at work. You can be poor and just strange, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you're weird. Oh my God, don't go near that guy. He is weird.
Right.
He sings or he talks to himself. Don't go near him. He's crazy. He's weird.
Yeah.
Same guy, if he had money, don't go near him. Go near him. He's eccentric.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Exactly.
He's got all this. He's eccentric.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Michael Jackson.
Right. He's eccentric.
Mm-hmm. He's eccentric.
I want to play with your son.
I'd like to sleep in the same bed.
And that's the parents' fault, by the way. That was the parents' fault.
Well, we talked about that whole thing, too. Like, the whole, like, the parents, people interviewing the parents, and like, oh, yeah, Mike, they'd come get the kids, and they'd sleep in the bed together. Like, you didn't think that was weird at all? You're an adult.
They were caught up in it. They were probably...
They were probably just as excited.
Yeah,
Michael Jackson.
Right. They were caught up in the glamour of it
all. Right,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, the biggest entertainer in the world.
Wants to hang out with my kid?
I mean, you could get caught up in that.
Sure.
I mean, Neverland.
Yeah.
Has his own amusement park and shit.
Right.
Adam, like...
Yeah, he had his own
and
zoo.
And he would spend money on anything. Anything he wanted. He had all the money in the world.
Oh, yeah, the bubbles.
Yeah, Bubbles the chimp.
Bubbles.
Yeah. Yeah, bubbles, yeah.
Then he had the Elephant Man's skeleton for a while.
Yeah.
Oh, that's weird.
Yeah,
he had his own personal doctor.
Oh, don't forget about the hyperbaric chamber.
Chamber.
Yeah.
So I guess some billionaire owns Neverland Ranch now.
Is it still called Neverland?
I don't know.
Or do you rename that? Do you rebrand that?
You have to, right? For sure. But you would have to like treat it differently. Like
it's a sex club now, not naughty puns.
Some billionaire named Ron Burkle owns it now.
Oh, he definitely is. It's probably like some kind of club.
He bought it for $22 million, which doesn't really sound like that much for that.
Well, it probably dropped in price for all the shit.
And only a few people who would really want it.
Yeah,
kids being molested there on that premises. I mean, come on.
Yeah,
okay,
it does have that stigma now.
So to that end, here's a quote. Strange to call $22 million a bargain, but a $78 million discount is a steal. So it was $78 million.
Wow.
So it was listed at $100 million and it sold for $22 million. So, and then apparently, they listed it at $100 million and then it had basically been in free fall ever since.
I mean, how's this kid's going to eat?
Yeah. How's Paris going to eat?
I mean,
and Blanket.
70 some odd million.
Blanket, don't forget about Blanket.
Blanket.
What a horrible name.
Yeah, forget it.
What a horrible name.
It's the worst name ever.
Oh, it's just the worst.
A kid's scarred for life.
Just the worst.
Hey, guys, don't forget to check out Last Flight Brewing Company here in Jefferson City. Sorry, Scott.
No, man, go ahead.
Have you heard it before? Outdoor seating.
I have.
They make their own beer.
Mm.
And also, Jamie, thank you so much.
I was
going to
say,
thank you.
Plug your store one more time.
Go ahead, please.
You got plenty of time, by the way.
All right. In the Groove Records, and the new location is going to be at 708 Jefferson Street, and I plan on opening April 19th at the new spot.
Sweet.
Perfect.
One day ahead of 420.
Yep.
I might not make it till the 20th.
So also we'll have to check in with you too, man, because Record Store Day is coming up, and we definitely want to promote that as well. So
yeah,
yeah, that'll be nice.
Yeah, that'll be, man, Record Store Day is always a fun time.
Always a fun time. Yeah.
I'm excited.
If you would like to check out the Old 77 on Patreon, feel free to check us out. Patreon.com/The Old 77 Podcast.
That's right. You can also give us a call on the listener line at 573-246-0779.
And you know where to find us on any place you can find a podcast. We are there knocking in your face.
Literally every platform out there.
Every place. And also check out the In the Groove has a Facebook page. Check them out. It doesn't matter what country you live in. You can live in, you know, New Zealand.
Oh, yeah. Our boy JT.
We're stalking to you, JT.
Yeah.
They have, you know, like I said, Jamie has a tons and tons of stuff there. So check them out.
And check them out. It's at In the Groove Vinyl.
Okay, guys. Well, Jamie, thanks again for coming out, buddy.
Thanks for having me. Thank you very much.
Episode 47 is in the books.
We'll see you guys later.
Yeah.
Da, 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 da. Bitches.